you to tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's clobbering time!
Let's get ready to rumble! Freedom of fire is such a rare. It's my son only know how.
What is up, Friday Nighters? Welcome back to another episode of Just Another Friday Night. I'm one of your two hosts, CM Chuck.
And I'm Double A.
And we are Just Another Friday Night, San Antonio's premier pop culture podcast with pee breaks, broadcasting live on Friday night to you on Facebook Live, on YouTube Live, and later on it'll be on Spotify for video or audio consumption. Double A, how the hell are you, bud?
Man, it's kind of rough this week. Kind of rough. You know, just the week seemed to take forever, and just it was long, and kicked my ass again.
Sometimes Double A comes in, right, and says he has a bad week, and I feel bad because my week wasn't bad, but this week, my week fucking sucked. Yeah, so yeah. We are in the same boat this week. I am ready for a beer.
Me too.
I'm ready to unwind and podcast and just drink this sixer and jam out to like a Black Flag song.
Ooh,
six pack, right? Double A, adrenalize me. Was there any news in the world of pop culture this week? I feel like it was kind of thin.
No, it's kind of thin this week, but we got a lot of things coming up. Mm-hmm. We got Super Bowl this Sunday.
Yes.
Finally, probably the biggest American event probably of the year.
Yeah.
Most likely, other than New Year's, I guess, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I
mean, mm-hmm.
Yeah, Super Bowl, man. It's where everyone gets together and watch two teams, you know, play
food commercials,
The halftime performances, like what we were talking about last week.
Yeah, we hopefully create some new memories to go the next time we do a Super Bowl episode. Mm-hmm. You posted up a lot of really great stuff that I had forgotten about, you know what I mean? It made me really want to see that Kurt Warner movie. I do want to see that.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, man, what a pretty great story that is for him.
It is pretty damn cool. Yeah.
Like from where he came from just to win one is like, that's cool.
Yeah, big time. That's cool. Then he goes like three times in his career.
Yeah.
That's pretty fucking excellent, you know? So we got that. Knock at the Cabin.
Yes.
Did you see that movie?
I have not. I saw it, right?
Yes, I saw it. I liked it a lot.
Okay.
Enjoyed it very much. Saw it Saturday.
Okay.
This past Saturday. I enjoyed it a lot. Batista, man, see him?
Yeah.
He really flexes in this movie.
Okay.
Like his acting chops.
Is
you actually like believe what everything he's saying and
Hello. Okay. Is anybody still there? Oops, something happened. Lost you guys. Cheers, Steve. Cheers, Steve. Sorry about that, bud. We don't know what happened either. That was odd. Even I commented on myself there that I said, are we here? Which we were. Hey, we're back. Yeah. In the words of Joe from Now Watch This Podcast, and we're back. So thanks so much for if you hung out with us during that weird break. I don't know. We had to like disconnect the Wi-Fi and then reconnect it. So
yeah,
technology,
it's
right?
Right. It's live. That's why we're live.
That's why we're live. There's no edits here.
No, yeah. No, sir.
Yeah.
You're getting the real deal here.
This is the real life experience here.
Yeah.
So I don't know what the hell we were saying.
We're talking about the Super Bowl. You know, and Kurt Warner, you're saying, you know, Knock at the Cabin.
Yes, Knock at the Cabin. You said Batista's acting was really great.
Real good.
Was it scary? Scary.
It's a thriller if you let yourself really get into it. Like if you really get into the movie, it can be. Because then you start asking yourself some questions here and there. So you're like, oh, fuck.
Did you, your brother actually suggested some movies for me besides The Menu. He gave me The Hunt and Ready or Not.
Ready or Not,
yes. I watched both, but they were pretty good.
They're funny, right?
They're funny, like a dark comedy, But there's a, you know, I guess a slight, I would not say horror, but like suspense aspect.
Sure.
Like a thriller almost, mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
So the beginning of The Hunt was pretty crazy, right? Because you got like a lot of kind of like named people.
Yes.
And then they all, you know.
Right, boom, exactly. Boom, boom, boom. Yeah, I thought that was a cool little premise, though. It was pretty good. And the Ready or Not, I thought it was enjoyable, too. That main gal
looks supernatural.
Yeah, and she looks a lot like Margot Robbie.
Yeah, a lot of people
I was like, that. Oh, dang, she very much resembles her. So those are pretty solid.
But then when you put the pictures, like.
You can tell. Ooh, yeah.
Yeah, because I still remember, and I'm really glad I didn't get in trouble, but like that scene, like in Wolf of Wall Street, when she opens the door and she's naked, I was like, I actually went out loud. I was like, oh, wow. And my wife was like right there. I was like, but I don't know if she didn't hear me or something, but I was like, and I was like, oh, shit.
That's a pretty common reaction, I think.
But I was like, that actually did slip out. Oh, wow.
Did that whole tall can fit in that mug?
Yes, it did. Oh, yeah, that's why I had to get the big gun out.
You know what? Let me have to turn this one just a little bit, like slightly towards you. Just turn it, I think. Oh, there it goes, right there. Yeah, that's what it is. I felt like I was in the shadow, and it was making my eye.
What are we doing in the shadows?
What are we doing in the shadows, yeah.
Oh, yes, I had to. This is why I got the big boy here.
Yeah, we're not using our normal mugs tonight, Double A. We're fancy tonight.
It's a bigger one.
There we go.
And then we got Ant-Man coming up officially Friday. But obviously, you know, Thursday showings.
Yeah. If we end up not getting Thursday tickets, guys, we will probably go Friday and move the show.
Yeah, because we'll tell you. Yeah, because we're not gonna like wait
we gotta
too
go
long
to that.
For that movie. You know?
Yeah. Oh, and I was gonna tell you guys I'm enjoying this Mexican style locker called Backyard Boogie. And it's from Second Pitch Beer Company.
Yeah, and they didn't have a 24 of the Modelo Lime, so I'm drinking Sol.
There you go. How's that one?
It's good.
Not too bad.
It's actually really, really good. I would recommend this highly.
You know
if
what?
You're last a fan week, of the
lime
and salt.
Last week when you dropped me off, somebody left this at my house. So it was like, all right. So it wasn't.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah, that
was
like, gathering.
There was people there. So I was like, you know what I did? I went in and said hello. I watched a little TV, then I fell asleep in the room.
Damn,
so I was tired. But it has been a hell of a week.
And we forgot last week to kind of mention, because it's like last week was our first time back in February. It is Black History Month, and I saw this great billboard by my work, you know, where it's like Black History Moments, and it had Jesse Owens, you know, winning the 4 medals in Berlin, Germany in 1936. Mm. You know, I was supposed to be Hitler's, you know, his Aryan race.
Yes.
You know, it's supposed to show the world, you know, the white power and all that, you know, his Nazism.
Ubermensch.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, and Jesse Owens went in there and
blew
at least the German runners away. I mean, he just blew them away. So
this isn't the famous Black Glove Olympics, right?
No. That's in the 60s. This is Jesse Owens. This is like black and white, you know.
Yeah,
and badass, it's crazy that fucker actually got to host an Olympic Games. I mean, it was
Hitler.
It was before, you know, the World War II started. Two years before the war would start. But I mean, it's just crazy to think that, you know, Berlin, Germany, you know, during Hitler's reign of power was the host for you.
Pretty wild. Yeah, that is pretty crazy when you think about it.
Yeah, I was like, oof. Yeah.
But yeah, you know, Black History Month, awesome, man. Wakanda Forever came out on
February 1st, which I was like, I didn't even think. Like,
perfect timing, right? Yeah.
That's why
yeah, they did so it. Yeah. A great, great tie-in there if you haven't watched it yet. Treat yourself and go watch it again on
It Disney is Plus. Missing Chadwick Boseman, though. I keep saying that, though, but I forgot how to pronounce his name. The actor who plays Neymar, he does a really good job.
Tenoch Huerta.
And he does, I mean, he does a really badass job to hold up that movie because it is missing Chadwick Boseman. It really is.
And then the shining performance from
Angela Bassett.
Angela Bassett, like we keep talking about it. And obviously the awards, people are seeing that too. It's a great, it's just a fun, great movie to watch. Like, just go check it out, Wakanda Forever, if you haven't seen it. Again, Disney Plus. I haven't rewatched yet, but I really been wanting to rewatch.
I've been wanting to watch too with my wife. Yeah. I think she'll really like the Mets game aspect. Mm-hmm. You know, great movie though. Like I say, a really good movie all around though, but.
Yeah, totally. And also go check out our old episodes. We have some really great episodes kind of, you know, I would say centered around and celebrating, you know, Black History
we
stuff.
Did. Yeah, we did in our first year. First full year we did.
Yeah, I think we have one called like Light Up the Darkness, which is a really great episode. We talk about like music, actors, you know, just the
pioneers.
Yeah.
All that, you know.
All the wonderful contributions.
Chuck Berry, Little Richard for rock and roll.
Yeah.
Cindy Poitier, you know.
I like that episode. We should do more episodes like that where we talk about, you know, the contributions of different cultures to the things that we love. Really, you know what I mean?
For our whole.
Yeah, for sure. Anything else, Double A? I mean, like, I feel like we're kind of in this moment right before, you know, we're going to get the Ant-Man stuff. And
yeah,
so
it's like, I know. It's like, it was really just really quiet. Like, Knock at the Cabin was like the first, like, really big new movie to come out since, like, Avatar. You know what I mean? Like, the movies really haven't been really
nothing really upfront. Going on.
I mean, there's really no, what, TV shows almost. I mean, streaming. I can't think of, like, a hot show right now that's streaming.
Is it Violent Night is out to watch on?
Yeah, it's on Peacock.
Peacock. Did you watch it?
I tried seeing a little bit. Okay. I was very kind of tired, but it was kind of dragging that first like 20, 30 minutes.
Oh, really?
Okay. So I was kind of like, so I kind of like, I stopped there. I just went to sleep. It was just, it was taking a while to build up. It's showing him like how he's like kind of like disenchanted with Christmas and that kind of shit, and they're showing like this family that's all kind of fucked up, this one family, and I was like, okay, I know it's gonna get to somewhere at some point. It's just, it was taking a little too long for me. I think I was just too damn tired. I was like, I can't keep up with this, not right now.
Sometimes you got to be ready to commit that time to it.
It's like you said, you've told me you gotta be in the frame of mind to watch a fucking movie sometimes, you know. It's like I finally was able to watch all the Tom Clancy movies. Finally, I got to see all of them now. Finally, now I got to watch the show, which I'm excited about. But, you know, I was saying CM because I was like, we're thinking about maybe doing a Tom Clancy episode. Mm-hmm. And I was like, it just got me in the mood. You know, after so many years, it finally just got me in the mood to wanting to watch these movies. And I'm so glad I did. Those are some of the best action movies, you know, that I've seen. Just, you know, espionage, spies, you know. I mean, they talk about shit that's still actually relevant to fucking today. I'm like, golly, you know?
Here we go. Joe's in the house. He says, yes, love the Batman spinoff, boys.
You're going to like what I say about Batman.
That's our other podcast, actually, we're working on, Joe. Our All Batman, all Batman Hour, we're going to work on there.
Junior Batman shirt, Chuck.
Anything else about the... news this week, though? Was there anything
really
else? I don't think so either. I mean, like, thankfully, there wasn't even any, like, you know, deaths or anything like that to report on. And again, it was just like I said, people are waiting for football. For Ant-Man.
That's gonna be a big low afterwards, you know, because
I know.
Well, I guess the other big news, now that you mentioned sports, LeBron.
Oh, right.
Did surpass Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, you know, and he is now the all-time scoring leader. And we're talking, he's probably going to stay another 2 years, and he's probably going to raise it up probably, I was guessing, maybe another 3,000-4,000 points, you know, that he'll
put it out of reach, right?
He'll probably, because for that longevity, to go that long, to score that much, that is, I mean, we've seen it. It's only happened 2 times, so.
Yeah, that's insane. It's pretty insane. So, it's kind of like.
I mean, congrats, you know, good for him, you know, for staying that long. You know, a lot of people are pointing out that, you know, well, Kareem didn't start until 24 when he was 24 because he actually played 4 years of
college
ball, you know. I mean, but
Great point.
But, I mean, you know, for him to go from 18 to still doing it, to still scoring that much, yeah, the team sucks. His team sucks no matter how much the star power, you know. But, I mean, for him to still be, I guess, averaging over 20-something points over a 20-year career, I mean, that just really goes to show you the sports is just taking care of the athletes a lot better. I mean, Tom Brady playing at, you know, what, 45? I mean, that's fucking insane, you know?
Yeah.
I mean,
let's see. Joe says, okay, we saw this one earlier. He says, love the junior Batman t-shirt. This is actually in my opinion, the leader of the Bat family, Nightwing.
I'll be your biggest fan on that pod too.
Oh, you'd be okay. I appreciate that. He says, is that fuck LeBron? He lost that game as well.
Yeah, he did.
Yep. He says MJ is the true GOAT. No doubt, Joe. Now on that I 100% agree with you.
That's the thing.
NBA sucks in general.
It really does. I mean, no one is really talking about the NBA anymore. Like,
it's
seriously,
it's gotten way boring, man.
It really has. Like, no one is talking about. We used to talk about basketball everywhere.
Love basketball.
Everywhere. Old basketball. Yeah. You know, I mean, it's just something happening. I don't know. Just the game just fucking sucks now.
You know what I hate to say, Double A?
The Durant's like in Phoenix. Like, he bit so much that he got out. Kyrie Irving bit so much that he's in Dallas now. It's like,
oh, wow. Man. Is he there? I didn't even think.
Yes, he's in Dallas because he bitched until he got what he wanted.
I just feel like it's one of those things, Double A, where it's like we look back on maybe like when we thought times weren't great. And you're like, no, man, basketball really was great at that time. It's like it's in the lull.
Like we always said, it, even the Tim Duncan era, all that period, it was – Spurs, Lakers, Sacramento, Dallas, Phoenix. I mean, they had stars, star power, you know?
Joe says, that's why it's on TNT, like other shows that suck. All right, that's a little jab there. I think we know where you're going there. Don't bury the lead too much, but okay. But, you know, it is a wrestling reference, and I do feel like that too. Sometimes I was thinking, like, some of those senior years were kind of boring, and now I look back and I'm like,
now
man,
they're
that was
actually kind of still
good
pretty good.
In compared to now, I'm like... You know,
because he still had Sean.
Yeah.
Sean was still fucking wrestling. You said Triple H still wrestling. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was like, man, we kind of took these guys for granted. Undertaker,
yes.
We're still going.
Even Cena.
You know?
I mean, I'm like, oh,
no,
like
I mean, Cena good. Too. Yeah. I mean, compared to the guys now, man, Cena's like a fucking Hulk Hogan.
I'm telling you, to
a lot of these guys.
I'm telling you, I'm like, right now, it's just kind of like.
Batista was fucking exciting. I mean, you know, he still had last vintages of Flair a little bit, you know, here and there, you know.
Although I
mean,
I will say I did love that Cody Rhodes and Paul Heyman promo. That was really premier.
That was really
kudos
good.
To them.
I love that line that he told Cody. It was like, you know, it was like, you're his favorite son, but Roman Reigns is the son he wishes he had.
And I said, like, ooh, classic nice. Paul Heyman, right? Because even he had me going with the tears
and
everything.
What a great deal,
you know?
Though, right? Like,
oh, yeah.
He's responsible. See, Rhodes is responsible for Bayley, for Roman, for Seth Rollins, for this guy. You know, I was like, damn, you know, like they set it up really good. That's why I posted in our other group chat. I was like, okay, I'm ready for Mania.
Yeah.
I was like, that what they just did, and if they continue that all the way till April 1st,
yes,
I'm into it. I'm gonna be into Mania. I mean, that was great. That was
really
fucking
good. Solid. Paul Heyman,
at first, you're like, oh, man, you know, it's just a big old love fest. And then you're like, okay, where's he going? And then he hits you with that one fucking final jab, and you're like, oh, man.
Yeah, and then I love, too, you know, when Cody lunges kind of towards him, but he's got the mics down, but you can still hear him. You know, he's like, I'm just a messenger. Yeah. You know, it's like classic. I'm like,
he's great.
This is pretty good.
Paul Heyman
is really
great.
Really underrated. I think he's easily up there with Heenan. You know what I mean?
So
that's a huge compliment because the brain was really, really, really excellent.
Yeah. Well, the brain was good at bringing the heat.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Paul Heyman's really good at just selling the main event. You know what I mean? Mm. Selling Brock Lesnar to you, selling Roman Reigns. He's really good at that. But yeah, Bobby was just good at bringing the heat to everybody.
So this is Joe's comment. Chuck told me this show was gonna be him laughing at Make-A-Wish kids, and then he says the Sunday wish he had hurt. So I'll give you a little insight to this, Double A.
Okay.
Again, I don't like to waste your time with this nonsense, but since we're here live, I might as well say. So recently, Joe places a post into one of our wrestling group chats. The post is of somebody talking about, I guess, a recent Japanese wrestler wrestled a kid again, kind of the way Kenny did that wrestled the 9-year-old. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And people were using that opportunity to shit on that wrestler and say like, oh, blah, blah. And then the follow-up comment, like, I guess the person that's into like New Japan and AEW wrestling posts, he goes, y'all are saying this. Meanwhile, this is happening on in WWE. And it's the photo of that cancer kid from Make-A-Wish, Connor, pinning Triple H.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Now, Joe, I thought this was funny that Joe posted this, and I'll tell you why. And he messaged me and said, why do you think that that's funny? He's like, they're making fun of Connor. Oh, okay. And I said, no, they're not making fun of Connor. What they're saying is that they used a kid in that wrestling match with Japan, and then the WWE also used a kid. Let's take out the fact that it's a Make-A-Wish kid and all he did was pin Triple H and it was, you know, a very nice Make-A-Wish moment for him or whatever, no doubt or whatever. But to me, it's the same premise. But I told Joe, I said, oh, you're just making it worse because you're using the narrative that, oh, you know, look at how bad these people are that hate on the WWE, you know what I mean? And they're using this comment about with Connor, the Make-A-Wish kid. No, that's not it. It's the same thing. I said this in the comments. I said, this is the same thing Democrats and Republicans do when they spin it. When you say, oh, look at the vile AEW and non-WWE fans because they're making fun of this kid. When it wasn't even one of them that posted it. It's like, I told Joe, I would never even have seen that if you hadn't reposted it. Yeah. I was like, yeah. I didn't know.
I wouldn't have known either.
Plus, Double H, these people are the biggest smarks. I mean, yeah. They're like the people that you say you hate. They're the online wrestling community. Yep. They're
the ones who, like, for whatever reason, it's like people today just want to make it like this versus this.
Right.
I mean, I've told you, CM, I watch just about every wrestling. I watched WWE. I watched Ring of Honor when it was still Ring of Honor. I watched TNA. I watched New Japan. I watched AEW. I mean, it's just wrestling. Wrestling's on, like my dad, we will watch the Mexican wrestling sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
Did it play off? I just like wrestling, you know?
Joe says, for the record, he wasn't shitting on Takashita. And he says, he told me that wait till Friday night to get more kids to laugh. And Chuck's the true one. Oh, there you go, Joe.
Joe. Yeah, it's just there's some fucking like division that is like they want you to be AEW and they want you to be WWE. I'm like, right now, both shows kind of blow balls. So, I mean,
it's kind of like when someone's like, oh, what do you like better, like pussy or blowjobs? It's like, aren't both great? You know what I mean? Like, I like both, you know? So it's like, what the fuck, you know? Oh, man, it's just, you know what I mean? Like, I go in there sometimes to see what the stuff that Joe's posting, and he's just in there stirring the pot, kicking the hornets.
Yeah, that's Joe, right? You know what I mean?
You know, Marvel DC, there you go, right? Joe's like, why can't everyone like both?
Yeah, what you see, I mean. Our shirts, we have shirts.
There you go, right?
Yeah, see? If you look in this room, you see both are in here.
Yeah, and the reason we don't like Batman is because he's
Batman, they just made him a douchebag.
Yeah, they made him a douchebag, and he's also this show that we're going to talk about,
it pretty much shows how much somebody hates him just like we do.
I know, and I like it. I like what they're doing with this. So with that, a great segue, right? So guys, tonight, you know, on our pre-Valentine's Day show, whatever, we wanted to talk about a show that kind of is about love.
Yeah, big time love.
And it came out in 2019. And
it's wrapped up its third season in 2022.
And they just released yesterday a Valentine's special about the two primary characters, which I guess some people could say maybe is controversial. Is it still at this point?
It's been like that for a long time. Yeah. And it's actually one of the relationships I never really heard shit about.
Yeah.
Honestly.
And this is a show that Joe, who's podcast partner, Lucky, is a huge fan of. And yet Joe is still not to watch it, I believe.
Really?
So we're talking about the great Harley Quinn show on HBO Max.
Well, Joe, I barely saw it on Tuesday.
Yeah.
You know, honestly, I just saw the first episode and I laughed my ass off about it. And I told him that night, I was like, hey, do you want to do this for Friday? Which I was like, shit, I don't know if I buried myself. You know, doing that because now I got to watch like 36 episodes, 37 episodes by Friday. You know, I was like, oh, shit, you know.
And Double A's hit me with some curveballs because he hit me with this one. And what was the other one we did that you hit me with? And I was like, shit, I did watch it, but it's been a while since I watched it. So I was like, I need to catch up. What did we do recently? I can't even fucking remember. But yeah, of course, I saw season one and season two.
The Offer, right?
Yes, because I hadn't seen The Offer in a while. And I was like, damn, Double A, we really should have done those right after I watched it. Because he knows my memory is shit. Y'all know that as the audience here. But I was super excited to rewatch. This show is 37 episodes, 22 minutes each. You can breeze through it. It's fucking hilarious.
It really is. I mean, it's rated R big time.
Oh, big time.
You know, it's just like what Joe says right here, just not with kids.
Yeah.
Just kids, friends. You know,
I get you.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like, oh, shit, you know, I mean, there's a Eyes Wide Shut kind of parody,
yeah.
You know, and even this last Valentine's Day episode, I was like, oh, fuck. I was like, man, this is like boy shit, you know, like the boys.
Oh, yeah. You know? And I got to say, Billy, when I first started season three, I felt like it maybe lost a little bit of its luster. I was like, oh, it's some of the jokes weren't as funny. But then as I carried through, I was like, oh, no, it's still just as funny.
There was a lot of good standalone episodes of season three. Mm-hmm. Where like season one, it's kind of like a long story. And season two has a story. Season three was kind of like there's not really a definitive story other than her wanting to like connect.
Right.
With the green.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, I was kind of the same way. But there was really, really good standalone episodes here. In season three, like I said, the Eyes Wide Shut, I was like, oh my goodness.
Oh, yeah.
Man, that was so fucking funny. I was just laughing hard. It was the Court of Owls.
Yeah, the Court of Owls.
Yeah, which I need to get. I do need to get that trade paperback because I heard that's actually one of the more outstanding stories.
Mm-hmm.
From DC. Oh, DC, the Batman from the Snyder, the Scott. I forget his name too. Is it? And Greg Capullo. I forget the name.
I forget his name as well. Joe, if you know that one, throw that out.
Scott Snyder. Yeah,
it is Scott Snyder, right?
Yeah.
I know. My mind was like Zack Snyder, but I'm like, oh, that's not it. Yeah. So, okay. Joe says, the gang,
that you put together. Yeah. King Shark, Clayface. I told CM my favorite hatchet named Dr. Psycho.
Which was like a surprise character.
Yeah, right? And then I looked him up, right? Guy? I was like, this can't be like a real fucking DC character, right? And I looked him up. He's from 1943.
That's insane.
He's a Wonder Woman villain. Yeah, I was like, oh, wow. Now, I was like, son of a bitch.
Double A, I'm going to pull it up real quick, the producers and stuff. But does James Gunn have anything to do with this? Because they make a lot of reference to him.
They make a lot. Even the movie Thomas Wayne is directed by him. I don't know if you saw that when Clayface is standing up when he's Billy Bob Thornton.
Yes. Yeah.
You see, it's like written and directed by James Gunn.
And they reference him many times.
A lot. Throughout. I mean, just a shitload. I was like, was he already a part of DC at this point? And I was like, well, it's 2022.
I mean, yeah, there's a couple episodes where Harley's wearing the Suicide Squad shirts. Yeah, which, you know, obviously he did those and she's from that. But Paul Dini's writing.
Paul Dini was one of the writers.
Yeah. It's directed by, there's several directors that direct the episodes, but writers, you know, Paul Dini's name is huge because obviously he had such a big hand in Batman the Animated Series.
He created the animated series, and he's one of the creators of the Harley Quinn character.
Mm-hmm. Looks like there's several.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot because I saw it was just.
Even Bruce Timm's name is attached too.
Oh, Bruce Timm.
He's the other
too.
Big artist that's involved in Yeah, Batman the Animated Series. So
when the show came out, it was on the DC streaming network first,
right?
Which I was like, damn, it wasn't that long ago. So I mean,
right,
yeah. So and then it got moved into the HBO Max, which apparently it got renewed in 2022 for a fourth season. So not too bad that you know with them canceling a lot of the shows. They're still going on with
and
this
and a while
one.
Back, I thought we had heard that this one was going to be canceled. I felt like right around the time the season three released, like a few weeks into it, they had talked about it being canceled, and then now we're hearing a season four. So I think that it's really there. And I feel like they really did this new Velma show in the style of this.
They did, but that one just
I know.
It's like, you know what, you're fucking up too much. I haven't seen it. I just read the reviews, but I mean it sounds like this is another, you know, thing of them really destroying like a really beloved favorite cartoon in the Scooby-Doo franchise.
Yeah.
You know, it's like these people kind of want to dissect shit like that, you know, and kind of just make it really different. And people are like, come on, you got to respect the fans a little bit more.
I watched an episode or two, I think, and like, I found it okay. Cause I mean, when I realized that they were doing it in the vein of like how this Harley Quinn is, where it's very like tongue in cheek, I was like, okay, like maybe it'll be worth a couple of laughs. I did feel like some of the jokes were a little forced, but I didn't get that far enough to see if they tightened it up. You know what I mean? Because
but you know, I mean, the whole point of like Scooby-Doo, once you get away from like the adult shit, it's kind of like it was always about the game.
Mm-hmm.
All of them.
Right.
right. You know, that they were friends and they solved mysteries. And it's like now they want to tear all that kind of shit apart. And it's kind of like, you know, for a long time, like for me in the '90s, still, I was watching that 60s Scooby Doo.
Oh, so, yeah.
You know, for a lot of kids like me you know, it's still like, you know, like, man, you're really kind of like, you're rubbing mud on the fucking Scooby Doo franchise.
Well, hang on. Let's talk about that a little bit. This is interesting. Real quick, we'll get to Joe's comments. Joe says Paul Dini is Harley's creator.
Joe, real quick, go back to that one. It's credited for Dini and Bruce Timm.
Yeah.
And that they're the co-creators of Harley and Terry McGinnis.
Nice.
So you got to give them both of them credit, you know? So, yeah.
Joe also says Bruce Timm heads up DC Animated.
And he should. Shit.
And he says, no, I think Harley was a hit right off the bat. Maybe so.
No, it was a hit. Mm-hmm. That's not the point, Joe. It's just, you know, how DC was like just coming out and just canceling everything, right, Tim? I mean, they're just like on a fucking canceling spree, you know? Yeah. It was like, it didn't matter if it was a hit or not. It seems like they wanted to start fresh with everything, you know?
And again, back when season 3 first came out, I was looking forward to it because I had been, you know, it's...
Joe's partner, Lucky, has said it on their show, and I've said it on this show, where I'm like, man, the Harley Quinn show is so great or whatever. I'm sure I can go back and find those old clips. And I'm really glad that you watched it. But again, when I heard it was being canceled, I was kind of like, oh, man, maybe it's not getting that much views on HBO Max or whatever. So I was kind of like, oh, that kind of sucks or whatever. But
which is weird because you never really know how that actually works.
Right, exactly. Like, how did they determine that? But now I'm hearing that season 4, like, that's great. But I want to double back real quick. And Joe, I would like to hear, and any of the Friday Nighters out there listening or watching with us, I would like to hear your perspective. So you're talking about the Velma show, and I read a lot of the bad reviews too. But could you not say that this show is kind of doing something similar?
No.
Like hardcore Batman fans would be kind of like, oh man, they're taking my beloved hero. And
it's like I said,
a goofball.
It's like I said, is it kind of like from like what Harley's thinking, what they're doing? You know, I mean, can she really be a reliable narrator? You know what I mean? Like, is that what she thinks Batman and Gordon are doing? They're just like Gordon's some fucking drunk, you know,
so
on the outside. Like,
yes.
Like, her thing is, like, this is, like, what she thinks Gordon is doing. He's getting drunk. He's a fucking loser that has a wife that's cheating on him. And Batman's, like, a fucking, you know, kind of like a moron or whatever. Yeah.
You know, so you feel like we're kind of seeing Harley's perspective.
Like, kind of like hers. You know, like, how she sees the Bat family.
Yes.
How she sees, you know, even Joker, like, she's like, you love Batman.
Yeah.
Like, you know, when she's like, pick, you know, you got to pick, you know, when
well, I think that's true.
Remember? Yeah. Like, yeah. You know,
I think Batman loves him as well.
Yeah. So, I mean, so, I mean, I don't know. I thought it was like, that's what I thought I was watching. This is like from Harley Quinn. You know how they always say, like, American Psycho in the book, you don't know if it's real or not.
Because the
narrator is really unreliable. You don't know if Patrick Bateman's really doing the shit or not, you know?
Yeah. Dirk Daddy in the house, he says, yo, yo. And then he says, Harley Quinn is great, is not for the kiddos.
It is definitely not.
Lucky, we appreciate you being here, brother. Feel free to plug your sale if you got it going on. We'd love to know more, man. We like to buy stuff.
Oh, she's great, Joe. Like, I was, like, really impressed at how easily she kind of slips into that role.
Yeah, Joe says, love Kaylee in the role.
And that's the thing that always kind of bothers me, too, is, like, kind of like when you're used to a voice, and then somebody comes, and it's kind of like, oh, shit, I'm kind of so used to this other voice. She actually does a really good job. Her accent's not as strong as the original.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's kind of there.
It's still there.
Kind of high-pitched and, you know, screechy, you know?
She doesn't sound like Penny all the time, you know, and we're talking about Kaley Cuoco from
Big Bang Theory,
and also apparently she's getting a lot of love on that flight attendant show.
I saw it. I was like, man, it was kind of hard for me to get like
into.
It was a good show, but it's one of those where you're like, oh fuck it, like nothing good is gonna come to the character until like the very end, you know?
What I mean? Fuck. Okay.
Like it's gonna be like one of those shows.
I kind of like that, you know?
I know,
like,
you know,
I mean,
yeah,
like,
I know.
Depressing shit.
But, you know,
so I'll check it out.
Like
now.
The first few episodes I saw, she's really good.
Yeah.
She really is. Yeah, she's really good.
Getting a lot of praise lauded on her for that too. So I mean, but obviously, I think the majority of maybe our fans might know her from the Big Bang Theory.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Super hot babe, obviously gorgeous. Yeah. The one that's with Leonard Penny. but I agree. Like when I first saw that it was her as the voice, I was like, oh damn, I didn't really hear Penny. And I thought she put a really great stamp on Harley.
And I think this is something that she was really strong about because she's like an executive producer as well.
Okay.
So I know she was like very hands-on into like, you know, wanting to make sure it stayed true to the Harley Quinn character.
Do you think she stamped it a little bit harder than Margot Robbie?
Yes.
I think so too. Yes. I think so. I think it's, and I love Margot Robbie's performance.
It's easier to flesh out the character more
in more episodes and animated. Not, and again, everything that Margot Robbie has done with Harley, I really like. Even that Birds of Prey. When I finally made, I got in my mind, like, you know, I'm going to give this a shot. I was like, you know what? She's really great. She's really lovely in it. I thought the whole thing is like, she's a great Harley.
She's good. Yeah, she's really good. But it's like, really don't see, well, I don't know. She's good. I mean, she really is. I don't know. It's just, I don't know.
Trying out this one too, AA. From the Carbach Brewing.
Oh,
Cerveza Especial. I'm drinking some Mexican style beers here.
Like he says, cheap prices.
There you go. All right. Look, what's
Joe up says there? The scenes as well where she's actually uses her psychiatrist.
I love that. I love that.
Yes.
We get back to Harlene Quinzel.
And Joe was like, he thought the Birds of Prey.
Yeah. It's good. Like, it just like got shot on so quick or whatever. Again, the classic review bombing, the classic fucking bitter fans. You know,
it's going to be interesting to see what Lady Gaga does.
Oh, I'm very interested in that.
And yeah, because I think we're going to get more of the, maybe this kind of Harley Quinn almost.
Okay.
You know, the just true I love, hope so. You know, so yeah.
And what I love too is that I liked Margot Robbie's Harley a lot. I really dug it. She's... But when I started watching the show, I fell in love with Harley.
Yeah,
I was like, too. I think I'm a Harley Quinn fan.
I did too. This made me more.
And Ivy.
It made me feel the same way I did about them in the animated series.
Yeah. Yes. You know, great. Yeah, that's a great way to put
it. You know, I've always been a Poison Ivy fan. You know, earlier, you know, a few episodes ago, you know, I'd always said I think Poison Ivy's due for a comeback in the movie in the big screen.
Totally.
You know, because she's really badass. She's really super strong. So yeah, I've always enjoyed the characters, and they paired up first in the animated series.
Right.
You know, that's as crime partners. You know, they weren't lovers in the animated series, but there were. That's where they meet each other, you know?
Yeah, and spoilers, if you have not watched Harley Quinn, we're definitely going to talk about that because they do end up in, you know, again, spoilers, if you haven't seen Harley Quinn and you want to watch it, you may want to pause. But I'll give you a 3-2-1, 3-2-1. They do end up together.
Whatever, which has been a long relationship. Yeah. That's already been, like, one of the most well-established, you know, love relationships.
Now, AA, do you know, did that start in the comics and come over to the show, or did that start in the show and
that
go over to the comics?
That started in the comics.
Okay.
Yeah, because they were just crime partners. Like, they were just, like, two badass women that just decided, you know what, I'm tired of Joker.
Mm-hmm.
You know, me and you get along. Mm-hmm. Your poisons don't bother me. You know, she has the same immunity, like, as Joker does, you know, where the poisons don't bother her. And yeah, they were just friends, and then I was somewhere in the comics, like somebody just put them together, and it was like no one really had a problem with it that I can remember.
Joe comments here, Ivy is used real well in the Batman games. That,
like I said, when it's Bruce Timm and Paul Dini, because I think they're involved in a lot of those games.
I think so too. Right? Yeah,
they know how to do it. Yeah.
And then Joe says there were hints of the animated series, but of course
they wouldn't be able to. No,
shit, sorry.
But of course, back then they couldn't do that. No, not at that time.
No, definitely not. And then again, I think that the animated series is definitely geared toward a different audience. This is very specific.
This is now something that you can do. That you can widen it, you know?
So I love the new look. I love the look she takes on here. And I've actually seen at comic shops that I guess there's a specific comic book series that's based on this because the art is the same.
Okay.
So I guess they're doing, like, I don't know if this is a separate story, but the way I viewed this AA, this series is almost like an Elseworlds story because it's almost like you get into almost like an entirely different universe.
Yeah, way different.
The Bat family.
The Bane's a fucking, like, loser in this show. Riddler is, like, gay with Clock King, and the Bat family just look like a bunch of morons. Gordon's like a fucking fat, out-of-shape drunk.
Just a complete loser, you know, obsessed with Batman.
Clayface is just like happy still being an actor. He doesn't even care what he looks like, you know.
It's a far cry. Clayface is such a far cry from the animated series Clayface I love, but I still find him so hilarious doing the English type voice. And I know that our friend from Tis the Podcast, Anthony Caruso, is a big fan of the Lady Gaga, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, speaking of her being Harley soon.
And if you see our podcast, you know, that's when it seems like, favorite fucking like villain.
I love Batman and Batman's villain Clayface and Mr.
And
Freeze
I was like, after all, I was watching this, I was like, man, I wonder if CM's gonna like this version of Clayface.
Oh yeah, man.
He's funny, but I was like, I wonder if CM's gonna like this version though.
And then too, like, I think we kind of get our first taste of like, you know, a lot of King Shark prior to James Gunn's The Suicide Squad.
Big time.
Prior to that, he's gonna come out in the game with, because. What in the Suicide Squad we get Stallone as the voice.
We get Stallone, and he's not really like an intelligent like fucking.
No,
shark.
Yeah, just kind of like a brute, right? And then I hear that in this new game that's coming out, it's going to be Samoa Joe is going to be the voice of King Shark, which is
Joe.
Cool, right? And this game is called The Suicide Squad Kills the JLA or something like that. So it's supposed to be like a new video game coming out.
Dork Dad comes in and says, "Kite Man rules."
Oh, man,
there you go. Fucking Kite Man. I was like, well, he likes Mexican food.
Yeah. And then that first scene when he's with Ivy in that first season, and he comes back, he's like, "I'm ready for sex." And she's like, "We came back for the antidote. Like, what are you doing?" He's like, "Oh, I forgot about that." He's like, "I figured because you wanted to come by kite, we could have took a car with it."
Bigger, right? I mean,
total. Who's the voice of Kite Man, Dolly? This is pretty good. I really
like
that.
Kite Man, I was like, wow, this is like a big time like Tick character. Like, have you ever seen the Tick cartoon?
Yes.
And they got characters like this all over the place.
And that's a great pull for Lucky, because I know Lucky loves the characters that are kind of like, you know, just like they're overtly, you know, funny in that sense.
Oh man.
And I think that the another thing about the show that's really fantastic is that the humor is written really smartly. It's really tight. The jokes kind of like roll one after the other. And what I told AA in my experience watching the first season, and you know, whoever we got here that are real Batman fans, I know Joe and Lucky are in the house. Some of that stuff will not land if you don't know anything about the comics.
Yeah.
If you don't know Batman the Animated Series, if you don't know Batman the character, the lore, these jokes kind of won't land. And I thought that was so smart. I was like, this is really written for kind of comic book fans, whatever. There's enough in there that would let anybody have a laugh, but the really in-depth stuff is just, and it's kind of almost like they leave it hanging out there where it's like, if you get it, you get it, and you're laughing at this part. If not, you just can move on to the next scene.
His name is Matt Oberg.
Okay.
The one who does Kite Man, and I don't recognize
him from anything. No other.
It says he's really known for some show called The Real O'Neills,
okay,
and Ugly Americans, and Heart of Dixie.
Okay.
And he started some show called The Comedians.
I've never heard that either. Joe also says that, yes, Paul Dini wrote the Batman games. Joe, I really appreciate, man, you've been dropping a lot of game stuff on us lately, whatever. Obviously, that's something that me and AA don't really cover, is we're not the hardest core of gamers.
No.
But it's really cool when you bring in that extra aspect, because we don't always, are not up and up on the video game stuff. What else, AA? What are some of the really, like, I guess, hallmarks of this show? I mean, obviously, the show, and we're going to kind of approach it broad because there's three seasons or whatever. And again, yes, they are short or whatever, but they kind of focus on central themes in each one. The first one is
pretty much like Harley's already tired of the Joker.
Mm-hmm.
And like her whole story, which is kind of cool because they even bring back the Legion of Doom back. That's pretty fucking cool. I was like, man, awesome.
Yes.
She's trying to prove that she's not a fucking henchman.
And a sidekick.
Yeah, and a sidekick that she's Harley Quinn, and she puts her own gang together, and she wants to prove that she doesn't love the Joker anymore and that she can be an A-class villain.
Yes.
But she fucks up so much along the way.
Oh, yeah.
And kills a lot of people along the way.
And that is something real quick I want to talk about. The animated violence in this show, AA, is excellent.
Yes.
If you're a John Wick fan, if you're a fan of...
Or even like Invincible, if you saw the cartoon Invincible.
If you like Daredevil hallway fights, if you like Punisher in the prison fighting, you're going to love this action and violence because it's greatly animated. It's gory as fuck. I mean, it's wonderful. The violence is wonderful. Harley uses the bat greatly. She uses like nothing is wasted.
Yeah.
Yeah, I even think Ivy uses her powers very well. Everyone uses their shit very well.
Yes, that was the one good thing about it. Because like I said, you know, Chris Nolan did such a great job, and Tom Hardy did a great job of Bane. That this Bane kind of like along the lines of like that idiot that you see in Batman and Robin, but smarter, I guess. I mean, it's terrible.
Well, it's more like, you know, we're not getting like obviously the hardened general we've known Bane to be.
The tactician.
We're getting this guy like hooked on venom that's kind of just like, you know.
And he has like a coffee cup that says caffeine is my reckoning.
Yes. And then he's like, I guess I'll be alone with darkness, my only friend. Yeah. You're like, fuck. Joker pushes him around. Like, what I like about this is that the characters kind of act like how we know them. Like, we know Joker is the king shit. He says it. He's like, I am the top tier villain in Gotham. Like,
yeah, they all listen to him.
Yeah, and yeah. he swings his fucking Joker dick, and he's just like pushes everyone around. He literally takes Bane's food at the bar
mitzvah. Yeah, he does.
He's like, ah, that looks good. I want that instead. He's like, I'll eat that. And he's like, okay, I'll take your chicken. And he's like, no, I might still want it. And he's like, well, what am I supposed to do? And I'm like,
you're like, you're Bane.
Yeah,
like,
Bane can kick the Joker's ass. Guy. You know what I mean? But what do you think about that, though? Like, we also get to see like Penguin's son bar mitzvah.
Yeah, Penguin has a bar mitzvah, and the Legion of Doom is invited. And it's like, it goes to like this complete shit show, you know, of course, you know, but I'm like, wow, the Penguin, bar mitzvah.
I mean, the whole speech. I was like,
it's just stupid.
The whole speech literally talking about finger banging or whatever. She's like, come on, I thought you said you finger banged or whatever. And he's like, I did it. I just wanted to. It's like, you're just, oh, it's over the top.
It's way over the top.
Penguin is kind of gangster Penguin in that.
He is gangster Penguin. You know what I mean? He gets killed. I'm like, what the fuck? And then like, you know, there's like a part where Joker gets Batman finally, and he's like torturing him for like a long time. And Scarecrow comes. Do you remember that part? And
I don't remember.
He fucking goes, I want to see who he is. And he unmasks him.
Oh, yes.
And he's like, you're Bruce Wayne. And Joker gets so fucking mad because he never wants to know who he is. And he shoots Scarecrow in the head.
Which is funny because a lot of the things that this Joker does is like, you're like, that's what he would do. Like, he's very. You know, he even jokes, he's like, I'm an agent of chaos. That's why you love me or whatever. But it's like, he does it. You know what I mean? Double A hinted at it earlier. He alluded to it. But there's a scene where literally Ivy's trying to prove to Harley that the Joker does not love you.
Yeah.
And she basically sets up where he has to choose. Okay, who are you going to save, Harley or Batman? It should be obvious, right? And he says it. He's like, it should be obvious. He's like, but go ahead, kill the broad.
Yeah.
He's like, I cannot be without you. Like, you know what I mean? Like, which is kind of funny. Did you watch the Lego Batman?
No.
The Lego Batman is one of the finest Batman movies you'll ever watch, AA, because once again, the narcissistic asshole that Batman is really, really shown. And I'm like, the Joker is kind of like the purity of the relationship, because Batman does not want to admit that he needs the Joker. And the Joker is like, oh, you don't need me? So he steps out of his life and starts living the straight life. Well, Batman is so obsessed with him that he's bad, he can't let it go. In the Lego Batman, and he's like, nah, man, I'm just like living regular, whatever. You say you didn't, you say you didn't care, whatever. And so, because he wants him to acknowledge that he is, you do need me, you do love me. And I'm like, yeah, you do, Batman. You really are, like, at this point, you're nothing without him.
Damn.
Like, you need the Joker.
Damn.
So it really highlights that, which I was like, oh, look at this fucking asshole getting put in his place. You know what I mean? Which is there. And he also is obsessed with being the top hero. Where Superman's there, he's like, no, I'm better than him, blah, blah. Like, it's like, I'm like, wow, they really honed in on the fucking jag off you are. As I feel like this show does wonderfully as well.
Oh, it does great. Like, this, like, somebody had like a like felt the same way like we did about Batman. Yeah, like,
were they just another Friday Night fan? They
right? I was like, we're gonna take this guy down a little bit more and show him that, you know, he's like this fucking prick, this that's the stiff prick that doesn't let anyone like do shit.
Right, you know? Right. Who always thinks he's right, who's obsessive, who's compulsive, who's fucking
he ignores Jim Gordon.
Yeah, he's equally deranged and psychotic as all the fucking people he locks up. I'm like, you belong in Arkham too, motherfucker. You just as horrible. So it's great in that. But yes, this is a great first season where it's like Harley wants to get in the Legion of Doom. I think we even get Superman in the first season, right?
We get Superman. Yeah. Because she's trying to find a number one nemesis.
She needs a nemesis.
All the great villains have a really great nemesis. So she's like, fuck, well, I don't want Batman. Yeah, I'm gonna go to Metropolis. So she kidnaps Lois, and you know, she makes a threat, and Superman just comes, and Damian's like persistent in being her nemesis. Damian comes out as Robin. You're like, man, he's like a really shitty little fucking.
Oh, you know, he's sorry a fucking ass, asshole.
You know? Yeah, he's like, man, he sucks. He just sucks real bad.
Again, AA, I really feel like this show plays into like maybe how like a casual Batman fan like you and I views the characters. Because I'm like my view of Damian now is this version where I'm like, yeah, that's how you are. You're like a little prick. Like, you're annoying. Like, you're all the things about we don't like about Batman amped up. Like, you're a jackass. You know what I mean? I'm like you're that fucking kid that I'm like, shut the fuck up. Like, go play. Like, get away from me. You know what I mean? Like, and he is that, which is funny when he shows up. Like, there, no one else from the Bat family comes. Like, he's the only one that all be your nemesis. And she's like, man, you're beneath me. You're like a kid. Which is great.
Yeah, it's fucking hilarious that, and you know, it's like they know how much that character. I don't even know if that character is liked or not. Honestly, I don't know.
Damian?
Yeah, I don't know where Damian's ranking. I know people that are not like Jason Todd, but I mean,
Double A, we had literally had James Gunn come out recently on a video and say, like, that's my favorite Robin. I'm like, oof.
Okay, never mind.
I'm like,
because the way they portrayed Damian, it was like, man, he was just a sorry little fuck.
You know? I mean, hey, we haven't had a live action Damian yet, right?
No.
So, no. I mean, James Gunn pretty much said he's given it to
there's
us.
There's only been Dick Grayson. I don't think there's been a live action Jason Todd. A live action.
There is in the Titans show.
Oh, mm-hmm. Okay. So Todd's in there. What about Tim?
Yep.
And Tim. Okay. Well, shit. Yeah. Okay.
We just don't have a Damian in that show. Okay. Whatever, so. Okay. That's what I'm saying. I think this will be whatever James Gunn gives us with Brave and the Bold might be the first live action Damian, which I think he is kind of a character that is liked by some people. Okay. You know?
I know there was like a series that's very like kind of beloved, like when Batman, you know, when everyone thought Batman died in mm-hmm. comics, Nightwing yes. takes over.
He actually puts on the cowl
and he trains Damian. And they said that them two that actually made Damian seem okay with the people. I remember when it was Nightwing and Damian that actually was very
now popular. That I could see because Dick Grayson is what Batman should be. That's what you want.
There's like
Batman.
So many like little fucking lines that like crap me up. Like I wrote one to CM mm-hmm. where you know they said you know Roger Goodell was in the Legion of Doom. Oh, yeah. And they were like and there we stand for the anthem. You know, I was like, oh my goodness, yeah. I was like Golly, you know?
Yeah, it doesn't pull any punches. The show is very out there or whatever, like where you're like, oh shit, like they put their political views out there. Like I said in kind of the write-up, right? It reminds me of like what we do in the shadows, but also like of Peacemaker, of Invincible, like you said, of the like, boys.
Like Dr. Psycho calls like Wonder Woman a cunt.
Yes.
Which is like very controversial for everybody. Like even the Legion of Doom kind of kick him out.
Yeah, they're all like, whoa, that is like a bit much, you know.
And then he says like a line. I wrote this CM. He goes, "What the fuck is Dickhead Tracy talking about?" I was like, man, I just fucking love that shit, man. It was just so fucking hilarious. It got me laughing so much. I mean, you had, you know, Giancarlo Esposito too as the voice of Luther. I was like, man, he sounds great too.
I mean, that, like, you know, his voice is so recognizable. And me, it should have been recognizable, but I didn't realize when Double A said, he's like, man, they got Michael Ironside back. And I didn't realize he was the voice in the
Superman animated series.
How cool is that?
Yeah,
right?
Like, I was like,
hey, Darkseid again?
Because, his fucking voice was so great as Darkseid. Like, Michael Ironside was just perfect for Darkseid. I was like, man, and they got him back. I was like, I got goosebumps. You know, I was
and
like,
listen to what we're saying here. Look at the characters that are coming out. I mean, you do get Darkseid.
Yeah, which
you
is fucking crazy.
You know,
too.
Lex Luthor. You get
Mr. Miracle, right? I told like super like CM because I'm a fan of Mr. Miracle.
Yeah,
and you know he's like, you know, his thing is like getting out of like any kind of like prison, whatever. Mm-hmm. And like fucking Harley bashes him in the face, you know, to get his to get the mother box so she can go to Apocalypse. I was like, what the fuck? I was like, man, she just bashed Mr. Miracle's face. I was like, damn.
She's very
he's like just persistent. Laying there upside down with fucking blood coming out.
And you know, again, we're kind of gonna hop around a little bit, but like for me, season 3, one of the highlights, of course, was like Nightwing appears. He hadn't come out yet.
Yeah, which was cool. I was like, man, you know, anytime we just get Nightwing, I just fucking pop.
Now, is he the badass that I know him to be? No, but you know, they also didn't shit on him as bad as they shit on other guys. They shit on some where they're pretty bad.
No, yeah, like him and Batgirl actually are okay.
Yeah,
their presentations they're actually all right.
They're all right. They're still a little like corny, but
bad. Like there's like one of the episodes is like an escape room. In order for like Harley wants teamwork with Ivy to show that they can work with Ivy, so she organizes an escape room for 1 hour, and the Bat family's there too, and like Nightwing's like having like this fucking like breakdown because like he's playing chess and he wins, but it's like you can't beat it, right? You're not supposed to beat it. That's the whole point of it. And he like goes on the roof and he's like, no, I let some, you know, one of the bad guys kill one of my guys.
Yeah,
and, you know, Batman's gonna score me and I don't deserve to live. And And, you know, he gets on a higher, like on a bookshelf, so he can die quicker. And Ivy's like, we're going to die in like 3 seconds. He's like, that's too long.
Yeah.
I was like, man.
And then later on when he's like, no, he's never wrong. No, he's never wrong. And it's funny in a sense because you're like, you know, it's almost a joke at like how blindly these kids kind of follow him or whatever. I mean, obviously, you know, Dick's a grown man now, or whatever. But still, it's like the point is like, this is the brainwashing of fucking Batman's ass. What I did love is at the end of that season, you know, is when they kind of he tells Barbara, like, you know, you'll be in charge of the Bat family, because there's different versions of this we've seen. We've seen where, you know, Nightwing is going to be the leader of the Bat family or whatever. So I like that. I was like, okay, you kind of put it in Barbara's hand. If there was a one and two, it should be them, I would think, or whatever.
Yeah. And then, Barbara was, you know, always that.
Yeah.
That other one.
You're definitely going to rank three, maybe Tim or whatever. Because I mean, like Jason's too off the rails or whatever. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But, so like the first episode for Nightwing, it's season three and it's episode two. And that episode is called There's No Ivy in Team.
Yeah.
And that one's a really good one. That's actually a really, really good, fun episode.
Mm-hmm.
It shows all of them, like you said, the Bat family. It kind of shows all of them working together and shit like that. But I mean, it's fucking funny, you know.
What would you say AA is like the theme of season two? Because at the end of season one, season we get like some crazy shit happening.
Season two is like clearing up all the chaos.
Right.
Because Two-Face has a sector and Penguin has a sector and Riddler has a sector, and she's trying to prove that she is the number one person.
Yeah,
you know. So yeah, that's like season two, big time.
And throughout, like Joker's kind of is there and like kind of like being like this thorn in her side.
Remember, you know? he gets normal at the end of season one.
He
actually lives a normal life for a little bit, and you see flashes of him where like something violent happens, and he wants to start breaking out laughing. He's like, What was that? You know,
yeah.
Like, what the fuck was that? You know?
And then is this where he goes to be the bartender?
Yeah, he's a bartender. Yeah.
And then later on, he meets the woman, the Mexican woman.
Yes, right? He's with her already by that point. Yeah,
and he's even with her by the Valentine's episode, which is hilarious.
He has two stepkids.
Which you're like, the Joker's a fucking stepdad or whatever. And then he's the mayor of Gotham.
Yeah,
too,
then he becomes mayor. He beats Gordon.
Which, he really wasn't a bad mayor. He had a lot of good policies.
Yeah, that's what they kept saying with Jim Gordon. Like, Dad, you don't have any policies. Like, no one knows. And like, Two-Face is like his fucking campaign manager. He's James Gordon's campaign manager.
Yes.
He's fucking stupid. And, you know, he's like, one of them was like, well, they don't think you going up against a man in a coma is very noble. And then there was like a, he goes, oh, okay, well, that's only 43%. It's like, no, 20% say you just suck. And there's another percentage where he says, we don't get James Corden.
Right.
Sings karaoke. And he's like, so I think people are getting us confused.
Doesn't at one point he does something nefarious, right? Two-Face, he literally tells him, he's like, I can't believe you. And he's like, my name is literally Two-Face. Like, yeah. It's like, it doesn't get any, why would you trust me?
Even Bane trusts Two-Face too. Remember, it was supposed to be Two Faces,
right?
and you know, he gets mad at that too. And man, it's fucking hilarious. Like Bane in Two Faces sector. Bane is supposed to be a partner, but he's like the judge too for Two-Face, and Two-Face is like the prosecutor, and they got Man-Bat coming out as like as the defender.
He can't even talk. He's just screaming.
Speak. Bat? I don't understand what he's saying.
Double A, did you watch? You watch Office Space clearly, right? Before,
yes.
I felt like Bane's character is very much like that's my stapler. Like, that's
oh man, yeah.
He's very much like meek, and you're like, what the fuck? And the whole time he's like, I'm gonna blow it up. I'm gonna blow up that place. And you're like, what the fuck? Like,
yeah, like his car gets declined.
Yes.
Like, you're giving my explosives to Calendar Man. What you gonna do? Blow up Valentine's Day?
I mean, like, again, too, they take so many jabs at those characters because he comes out quite a bit, Calendar Man. You know what I mean?
Like, he does. I'm like, what the fuck, Calendar Man? I was like, ew.
And I want to talk a little bit too about how wonderful Lake Bell is as Ivy.
She's great. Okay,
Lake Bell, I think she has done some live action stuff.
She has.
I mainly know her from voice work. She's beautiful.
Yes, she is.
She could be an on-screen actress. But I first recognized her name because she's who they got to be Natasha Romanoff, who they got to be Black Widow in the What If series. But she is even more wonderful as Ivy in this because she's so smart. Obviously, the way the relationship works, right, AA, like the comedy duo of this series is Ivy is like the straight man, and Harley is obviously the wacky one. You know what I mean? So and it works so well because even though
in part three though, it shows like Ivy being really scary.
Oh yeah, definitely. Definitely.
You know, you're like, oh shit.
But when Ivy is being deadpan and delivering jokes and being humorous, it's very, very funny. Her humor is dry. Yes. You know, her tree hugger pajamas, you know what I mean? Like her just wanting to be this like homebody, like plant lady is like, she really plays into it, and it really is it adds to the hilarity of her character.
Joe says, wasn't she in Wakanda Forever? Yes, she is. So if anyone can remember her, she's at the very beginning with the helicopter.
Yes.
But she doesn't stay in the movie very long.
Very long, right. Yeah. Yes. A good call. Good pull, Joe. That's an excellent one. Catwoman is a frequent character throughout, played by Sanaa Latham, who double A reminded me. I forgot Blade's mom in the original Blade movie.
Super gorgeous.
Super gorgeous. But I also love her too in Alien vs. Predator, the first one or whatever. She's the primary human character.
She did a Tyler Perry movie where she's really fucked up in that one too.
Oh, really? So, okay. Yeah. Okay. Great actress, whatever. And she's wonderful as Catwoman. I love this like sultry, like I don't care, big nonchalant time. Catwoman or whatever, who has Bruce Wayne around her fucking little finger. Yeah, like real it's bad. So hilarious.
Joe goes, when Ivy and Harley are using Catwoman's house, using all the stuff she's stolen. Yeah.
Yeah. That's great shit right there, man.
A lot of good episodes where, you know, the Queen of Fables.
Yeah.
That was fucking funny.
Yeah. Where she's like trapped in the tax code.
Yeah. The tax code book. You know, that's fucking hilarious. You know, when they get her and she murders that entire family. You know, I was like, what the fuck? You know, like, I was like, damn, like, they really kill like a shitload of people in this cartoon. Like,
Double A, the very beginning, right? I mean, like, now I don't know if this is a character that is from the comics. I do not think so, but Frank the Plant, Ivy's friend, Frank the Plant, voiced by the fucking wonderful J.B. Smoove. If you don't know J.B. Smoove, you've seen him in shit, but mainly what he's known from is from Curb Your Enthusiasm. He's wonderful.
I was going to say, maybe for a wider audience, the teacher from the Spider-Man movies.
Yes, yes. Great. Yes. Cool. Double A. I forgot about that, too. Yeah,
like, especially, I guess, the second one.
Right, right. Not the coach, because the coach is Hannibal Buress, who's a different comedian. But J.B. Smoove is the other teacher.
He's close with them. He's a black teacher with a white teacher, but in the one with Mysterio, I forget. Far From Home.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, he's that teacher.
And he's great. He's got a very distinct voice, and he plays Frank the Plant, and Frank the Plant is fucking hilarious. How about when they're like, Ivy tells him, like, Frank, where's the kid that was supposed to be watering you? He's like, oh, yeah, I got hungry. And then it's like,
man, he ate him out. Yeah.
And then he ate the parents, too. She's like, what about his parents? And when they come looking for him, and he's like, oh, yeah, don't worry about that. And he spits them out, too. They're all deteriorated and shit.
Man, I was like, damn.
He kind of looks like a Feed Me Seymour, right? Looks like one of those plants. Oh, is that what Joe just said right there? Let me see here. Joe says, reminds me of Feed Me Seymour. Great pull, Joe. Fuck, did that plant have a name? The plant did have a name in Little Shop of Horrors.
Oh, shit.
Because there was two. It was something one, something two. God damn it, I can't think of it. It'll come to me later. Joe, you're listening, and what were some of your favorite moments? But I want you to give me a favorite moment, and Luck, if you're still there, you too, if you can. But that ties to the comic. Because, again, I felt like there was so much stuff in there that was little nods to the comic. Obviously, in season three, and again, I don't know if you guys have seen it yet, so spoilers, I don't want to ruin it for you guys. But there is some heavy Batman animated series references, you know, including the lightning flashing and them on the roof.
Mm-hmm.
But I just told Double A today, I was watching this with my girlfriend's youngest son, and he was laughing at the obvious jokes, but there were little things that I knew that he missed, because there's some huge references to the Adam West series. Well, you text me, Shark Repellent. I mean, that's
the fucking Shark Repellent. I was like, what the hell? I was like, they brought that out.
Easy pull or whatever. Later on, when they're in Bruce's memories, he's literally running around with the bomb, and he's like, I had some weird years. Then they show the penguin with the penguins on the back, like the Burton years, you know?
And then you even see, too, like when Joker's about to host the Villies. Like, I think that Robin even dances like that, too, you know?
Yeah, and then I was telling Double A, there's a really cool moment where, like, Harley's in his mind, and she realizes that he's Batman, and it shows him suiting up, and he buckles his belt, but he's got the purple gloves on, which is like, holy shit, like, that's old school Batman, like, you know, like, and only if you kind of know will you get that? You kind of pop for that because it's a little geek out moment.
Just not even going to
If anything, you might think like, why were his gloves purple? That looks wrong. They messed up. But you're like, no, if you know, that's like old school. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And very, that's even like cool. Sam said, that's even like kind of like even if you notice, you know?
Right. Which is like, I felt like there were many moments throughout the series that made me feel like I popped as a geeky fan of like Batman, the Animated Series.
I mean, even the helicopter was Adam West.
Yeah.
The one that Nightwing gets in with Alfred, that's a fucking Adam West helicopter.
And I don't know if in the comics, AA, like, he had a Batwing before the 89 Keaton movie or whatever. Mm. But ever since then, anytime he has any type of jet, they call it the Batwing. And it almost always looks like that. Like they almost draw like that. Mm. And in this, they use that too, which is very, very cool. So I really was like, I dig that. They give it the name.
I mean, like you said, though, obviously, too, the Legion of Doom. I mean, man, if you're like an old school fan of like the Super Friends, you know, wow, it's like, I was like, man, could that be it? Like when I first saw the layer design, I was like, the fuck is that really the Legion of Doom?
They went right in.
I was like, wow. And then, you know, they talk about Sinestro and, you know, all these other guys that were in the Legion of Doom, and Lex obviously being the leader of the Legion of Doom. I was like, holy shit, man, that's pretty badass.
Aquaman, Ocean Master. Oh, they talk about Jason Momoa, although they don't tie the two together, but it's just funny. You know what I mean?
Aquaman looks like Aquaman, his long blonde hair.
Classic one.
He's kind of a douchebag too.
So. Yeah, kind of a douchebag, like he's supposed to be.
But like they kind of make fun of him too for losing to like Poison Ivy too. So
right,
I was like, golly.
Joe says, she's like, I've been in your head and I know who you are. But Dr. Patient Confidentiality. Yes, I love that too. They leaned into that.
See, that was really cool too. Like that was a really good episode too, where it's kind of like Ivy hasn't. I mean, not Ivy. Harley. Excuse me. Still kind of has her sanity still a little bit that pops up here and there. Like it was really cool that she was kind of comforting Bruce. Like she was smart enough to know, okay, let me get him the fuck out of here.
I thought that was pretty grim actually. He was like, oh yeah. I just live this one memory over and over, which
and
I'm
she's
like,
she's actually helping him. She's actually using her doctor skills, you know, to actually help him a little bit, you know?
Yeah. And then I love the joke too where Harley's like, oh shit, it's Joe Cool. And then she's like, no, that's when Snoopy wears the glasses or whatever. And then who is it? It's what's his name? The doctor, the guy, the little guy.
Psycho.
Dr. Psycho. He's like, no, I thought that was the cigarette guy. She's like, no, that's Joe Camel. So it's like a whole thing, whatever. I was like, fucking the Joe Chill thing. And you know, that's kind of dark. Like it's your kind of
it
like,
really
oh,
is, because like he's like, you know, or I need to get him back to watch his parents die some more.
Yeah, like, he's like, no, we're not allowed to feel good or whatever. You're like, that's fucking brutal. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, it's like the whole essence of Batman.
What's funny too is like, even like the Billies, they have these awards and they're held like by Crime Alley where Batman's parents die. And then one of the awards is like, you know, the Joe Chill Award. Oh, like, fucking Joker.
Yeah. And then Monarch Theater is like there, you know what I mean? So it's like they've always got, you know, shit like that. Like there's
she was like, you know, that he didn't want to go to the play. He wanted to go see the Zorro movie. And she's like,
right.
And you know, he's going on and on. She goes, wow, all of that for the Antonio Banderas movie.
And he's like, no. He's like, never mind. Yeah.
I was like, man. But I was like, man, that movie's actually kind of old enough to be already that Zorro movie.
Yeah, you could make it that way, right? Because, I mean, like, Bruce Wayne's supposed to be, like, perpetually, like, what, like 30, 35, you know what I mean? Like, unless you're talking Dark Knight Bruce Wayne, so you're kind of like, the motherfucker, he's just a man, but he don't age. I mean, again, it's so tightly written with all of the jokes like that. Yeah. And it's like, there's something for like everyone, because I know like not everyone's going to get those Joe Chill jokes.
No.
It's like, if you got to be like Fast and Furious, like what? Somebody else might be like, what? But of course, and you've got like, you know, Bane fucking buildings or whatever. Yeah. You know what I mean? You're like
okay, literally fucking buildings.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, well, that's just a fucking funny ass dick joke.
Yeah. Know? So like that Valentine's Day episode was not what I expected whatsoever. Man, oh man. I was laughing hard. Like, fucking Harley wants to give, like, Ivy, like, the best fucking orgasm ever. And so she goes to Etrigan the Demon for, like, a spell that will, like, make her fucking she sounds like she's dying. You know,
that's great use of him, right? Yeah. Like, he gets pulled in. And earlier in season two, we get Zatanna.
And she's there too with Flash. I was like, And then Bane, like, Bane has like a fucking separate storyline too. He meets it, he's lonely on Valentine's Day, and he meets this like dominatrix, and she's like, you know, you got me hot kind of back there. Why don't we go back to your, my place? You know,
he's but like, what's funny is that she thinks that he's there for the same shit to punish the guy because he's in the fucking black mask. Yeah. And she's like, oh, you're here. Like, and he's like, kind of like, okay.
Like, he just goes with it.
Yeah.
But, like, but she's like talking about like this guy's like little dick, you know, and kind of like berating him. And Bane's like, oh, it looks average size to me. You know, and he's worried about his dick size. So he goes to Etrigan too, to, you know, have a spell for his dick to get bigger. And, you know, he starts rubbing. He's like, oh, it's on fire. What's going on? And it's like, you're not supposed to use it if you use HGH. It makes it this fucking giant monster with a big dick, and he's like super horny. He can't help it. He can't help himself. He starts fucking buildings until they collapse.
He's like literally like fucking anything he sees or whatever, which is hilarious too, right? Because it's like, you know, they call it HGH, which like we know Bane's on Venom, on right? But it's just like, it's just steroids. He's just fucking roided
it's
up.
The thing about Bane, it was like, golly, it's fucking me. It's like he just pumped up on steroids.
Joe says, love what they did with love that they did the Forces of Solitude.
Were they watching the fucking porno? And Jor-El comes out. It's like, what are you doing here? Only Superman's supposed to be in here. Are you watching a dirty movie?
Yes.
And I forgot like, about like, that. It's like a Harley. They already made a porn about Poison Ivy and Harley Quinn. And they're fucking in that porno movie. They're watching the Forces of Solitude.
Because they're like, they become the new it couple, right? In Gotham, you know? Just as bro, the Bane mask is an animated series mask.
It fucking sucks too. Like Riddler is making himself like a cup of coffee, and like Bane comes in and starts talking. You see Riddler like keep looking at the fucking time, and so he just pulls it out with like a minute left. He's like, he just gotta get the fuck out of here already.
Like the whole shit, the Legion of Doom is like fucked up. Like it's like the inner office politics there is very hierarchical. Like it's fucking the worst.
They even got like a place for like goons. Yeah. Where, like if you're like like Harley gets accepted, but her guys like go to like the bottom level where if Bane wants to use them, he can use them. And they're like, what the fuck? Like,
right, you know,
we're,
right.
we're not just like fucking henchmen. We're Harley's guys. We're not going to go with you on this mission.
Which reminds me a lot of, and I want to, I'll try to segue here, but reminds me of, the Familiars, remember, and What We Do in the Shadows.
Yes.
They got that fucking
it's with that bucket.
Yes. Yeah. And speaking of that, we just read right now who is the voice of Nightwing in this show, Harvey Guillen, who is Guillermo in What We Do in the Shadows. I love Guillermo, so I'm like, I'm cool with him being Nightwing. I mean, like,
actually, I didn't even hear.
Like, I couldn't hear
Guillermo voice.
Me neither.
You know, very so well done. he did really good. No, he did really, really good as Nightwing.
Hey, Double A, it gives me hope that maybe one day I could be Nightwing because I could just do the voice, maybe. You know what I mean? So,
do the voice.
I don't want to be too Batman-y, but
you're going overt serious.
I knew it should be more like this. Yeah.
That Bane, I love fucking Bane in this one. It sucks what they're doing to his character, but I just couldn't help but laugh. I mean, he had a big Valentine's Day story. That was fucking funny.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. I mean, too, and like he becomes a lovable loser where you feel for
which
Bane,
is crazy because like, he's not even that guy. He's like the one guy that actually beat Batman.
Yeah, you know? Like you know, he's fucking scary. And like Dark Knight Returns, you're like, fuck, like he fucked him up.
He fucks Batman up. He held Gotham.
And in the comics, he fucks him up too.
Yeah,
you're
like he's the one guy that actually has some wins over Batman.
Yeah, he's like a bad dude.
He treats him like a fucking idiot there. Everyone just runs over.
Which again is funny too, because it's almost like again, like maybe how comic fans view it, where it's like, yeah, there's tears though. You know what I mean?
I know,
like,
but that's so crazy.
And Joker's at the fucking
top. Yeah, he's at the top. And they do not disrespect the Joker like one bit in this cartoon, right? Like he's like the one fucking character that actually is like still fucking scary in the whole fucking cartoon.
Oh yeah. And he's fucking crazy too.
Yeah,
so
like real
that's
crazy.
Really cool. Joseph, if you ever heard Kevin Smith's Bane, it sounds similar. Joe, I would love for Kev Smith to write or direct an episode of this show because I could just
it was
imagine.
So funny, Sam, because I actually had to look. I was like, man, it can't be Tom Hardy.
I know, right? Yeah. There's so many good things about it. what are some other moments, Double A, that stand out?
Like I said, the Court of Owls, you know, the episode where they're trying to find Bruce Wayne because they find out Bruce Wayne stole Frank the plant.
Yes.
And they're, you know, Ivy's like losing her fucking mind. She's like, what the hell? Where's Frank? You know, he's been my friend. He's like the one guy that can talk to you, or the one person, whatever creature, you know, before Harley came in that, you know, I can, you know, fucking talk to you.
Yeah.
She's going ape shit. And they're like, well, you know, every rich guy goes, or they find a clue. It's like an owl. And it's like a very popular storyline. See, I don't know if you ever read it.
I've heard of the Court of Owls. I've heard of
it too. It's kind of like an Illuminati thing, you know, that's been running.
Which I thought was cool. Again, Batman gets all the kind of cool stories.
And it's, you know, it's probably just because it's easier, honestly. Yeah. I mean, most people always want to work on Batman. I mean, would you want to work on Batman if you were in DC? I know we've both said Superman would be probably our go-to guy, but you can probably
Would be my go-to, but
you can probably have more range with the Batman character.
Well, like you just said, it's easier to write.
It's easier.
It'd be easier to write because the challenges make more sense or whatever. You know, with Superman, I have to write something that's
epic,
insurmountable.
Right?
Kind of
big.
Well, that's what I tell you all the time. I love about this Superman and Lois show is that it's his challenges as a dad. You know what I mean? It's like his powers don't mean shit there or whatever.
Yeah.
They did a very good job of doing what we said the original did with Jonathan Kent's death, where it's like he just had a heart attack. It's like your powers don't matter. You know what I mean? Like there's no way Superman could have stopped that or whatever, which is what Man of Steel fucked up on big time. Because I'm like, there's no way. Terrible. I know it's terrible. We always say this.
Come on,
there's no way I would. Yeah. Or Zack Snyder.
And it was him too.
Yeah, but both of you fucked that up. That's fucked up. I mean, like that. First movie has that perfect. That's exactly how you have to write Superman. You have to write it with a situation where your powers don't matter.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
And not that's where you could have stopped it.
Yeah. When his sons are getting mad at him in the show Double A, and they're like, so this is why you're never around. And they're pissed off because they missed, you know, the kid missed making his first touchdown. And he's like, well, I'm saving the world. They don't give a shit about that. They're an angry teenager. They're like, fuck you, dad. Like, you ain't here. You know what I mean? And it's like, you feel for him. You're like, now you've made Clark and Superman vulnerable or whatever.
Yeah.
That's what that show does really well. Man, I got way off.
No. I mean, it's fine, but it's like how we're
saying. But you're saying that Ryu would write it. Oh, yeah. That's wonderful. That works for him. That works for Batman.
Worked for him.
Yeah. I like it. I like this idea of this shadow agency running things behind the scenes. Illuminati of course, style.
Obviously, though. This is not what this is here. And I started laughing immediately. So they get the mask. And they start doing the Eyes Wide Shut
piano. They leaned real into that.
And they're, you know, they ask, you know, like, what's the password? And it's like, who? And Harley's like, who? Like, are you fucking kidding me? You know, that's a fucking password, you know?
Yeah.
And they go in there, and, you know, it's like, it's all fucking, you know, the robes, the mask, and they play the music. And they're like, well, after some talks, you know, we can't sacrifice any more like real living creatures,
right?
We have this piñata we're gonna sacrifice, and then afterwards they're like, all right, grab your dildos or whatever.
Oh,
and,
fuck.
You know, they start for the orgy, and they turn off the light, and
yeah,
like, what the fuck? And everyone just starts fucking each other. It's like, I was like, wow, this is like boy shit, like right here.
It has the boys vibes. Double A, didn't you? And I'm kind of gonna sidetrack, you watch all of Wednesday, right? I hated when that secret passage to the thing was like the two snaps. I was like, okay, like I get it. That's, you know, from the da 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 da. But I was like, it's so, that's your,
it's hoot hoot.
It's hoot hoot. I felt like I was like Spaceballs. 1, 2, 3, 4. The password is 1, 2, 3, 4. That's my luggage. You know, I was like, fuck, man. But what is it, President Screw?
Go to that last one.
The last one. Yeah.
He goes, dude, I need out lube and spermicide.
That's right. It's fucking great. Gross. I mean,
like, my wife was watching it with me. She's like, what the fuck's happening? I go, you're seeing one person eat someone out. You're seeing this guy fuck this other guy in the ass. You're seeing all this other shit. You're like, what the fuck?
I'm literally like listening to the last episode right as I'm like typing the write-up, right? And I know Jess is hearing it. It's just coming off my phone. And it's like all this about like, it's like, I've got to fuck Fred Goldstein or whatever. And I'm like, oh, man, she's probably, what the fuck are you watching?
Which I was like, man, I bet she was like, well, man, one of the Ted Lasso guys.
And I was more like, man, Hercules? Man, fucking poor. I wonder if that was his real voice. And they just got somebody. But that shit was fucking hilarious, too. And then Clayface in love with his own ass.
I was like, was like, what the fuck is this story? I'm like, fucking
gross. I kept thinking that he was going to end up eating out his own ass because this show would go there. I was like, oh, he's going to end up
They're there, I told my wife, I go, oh no, Bane's going to step on him and they're going to pee together. I was like, oh shit. And then he's like,
no. Let's see, Joe also says, how about that episode that shows two fans talking about hating different Batman?
It's like nice one of the shirts is like The Last Jedi is non-canon.
Yes. And oh my god.
I think
god.
It was released the Snyder Cut, I think was the other one. I can't remember, but one of them is like The Last Jedi is not canon.
Fucking stupid. Which again, it's like a perfect interaction. You're like, okay, that's fucking so something.
And, you know, obviously they're in the basement.
We've been a part of
they're in the basement. They're, you know, and they're they're, you know, it's these two fucking nerd looking dudes that are criticizing all the shit, you know.
It wasn't afraid to take punches at all that stuff. So I really loved it. I loved that it didn't hold back. You know, what I mean?
And, you know, it's like little details. Like my wife was laughing too, going back to that Court of Owls ones where like Gordon had to put on the mask, but he put the glasses on top of the mask.
Yeah.
She's like, he's wearing the glasses over the fucking mask. Because like they keep going like
that. Right. They keep falling down. Yeah. And then what's Bruce doing where they're kind of like convinced about him too? They're like, what is it about you? Something about that.
Oh, the shadow. Like,
the shadow.
Remember
the
shadow is fucking Batman. I was like, what the fuck?
I'm like, fucking dumb asshole. You know what I mean? I'm like, they just make him too. You know what I need more?
And then he gives money to Gordon. He's like, yeah. If I give you money, will you leave me alone?
Will you leave me alone? Which he's like obsessed with fucking Batman. Then he's trying to like hang with Bruce Wayne. It's just like they make him fucking like, again, he's like the Bane of the Batman, where I'm like, man, Gordon is just like a fucking
Gordon
loser.
Gordon sucked. I was like, man, Gordon's always been like one of my favorite characters, and he just sucks so bad in this show. He lives with Barbara in the college dorm.
Yeah.
And then he gets out of the shower, and he has like the towel wrapped around his head.
Well, because again, Gordon is kind of like this like almost backbone and like this like really intelligent, really like he's a very like a Cap mentality, Captain America, where he's very like dedicated to service. Like,
read Batman Year One, Frank Miller, that is a great Jim Gordon story.
Yeah.
Really, it is. Yeah. It's a really, really great Jim Gordon story.
I also love, too, like how, you know, Gary Oldman portrays him, whatever, and gives him such,
better. That was the best James Gordon I had seen.
Yeah.
Yeah, because the other ones don't do it. The Keaton ones really don't do it. The Clooney, the Kilmer, is like
Keaton Gordon blows.
Yeah, I was like, Knox was like taking all the shots, you know. All
right, not even that, but I was like, the only thing that he says that's memorable is like, he gave us a signal. Great shit, man. Let's see.
And then Two-Face is like, oh, you got great pictures, you know. He's like, hey, we can use these for blackmail. And, then fucking Gordon's like, yeah, but the one of me and Bruce, we can put that on the billboard, right?
Yeah. Joe says Year One animated movie Gordon kicks ass. Oh, okay, very nice.
I told TM, I go, hey man, you know, if you ever want to do some of these animated movies, you know, because right now we're in a big lull. I was like there's so many of them that I want to check out that I'm like, we can probably do this one, we could probably do that one, we'll probably do that one.
Yeah,
we haven't really hit up the DC animated movies, which is like their fucking gold standard for DC over there. That's
really
like
is.
The one thing that you can't touch DC on is the fucking animated movies.
And I love it.
Or the shows. Obviously this one. I mean, I was like, I saw one episode of this one. I told TM, I was like, how about we do this one for Friday? I was like, man, this show is so fucking good.
Which it was like, oh shit. Like it put me like in kind of like, oh damn, I got to like get back on it mode. But again, it was such a joy to go back and rewatch some.
Oh man, they're so fucking funny.
Again, I don't know what happened with that. I had started season three, but I hadn't finished it out. But then when I was like, oh, perfect time to finish it out. It was perfect time, perfect with the Valentine special. Like
that too, which I didn't even know about. I was like, I was just like, oh shit, there's a Valentine special that's coming out Thursday.
Yeah.
I was like, that's gonna be perfect. And then here to you, like Harley kind of like fucking explodes to you when you know Ivy Catwoman tells her and Ivy used to hook up, and that drives like Harley insane too.
Yes.
And she's like, what the fuck? You hooked up with Catwoman.
That's great shit right there. Let's see. Joe says Justice League Dark. Both movies are great. Perfect. I wouldn't mind checking those out for sure.
Man, the Mr. Freeze episode was fucking hilarious. You know,
remind me of that one, because I don't remember exactly what happened.
They're pissed off because she's pissed off because she lost time because she got frozen.
Right.
I don't know if you remember. Right. Nora, he freezes her. No, he freezes Harley. And Harley was frozen for a certain amount of time. And she's like, what the fuck? So she wants to get revenge on Mr. Freeze.
Oh, that's right.
Trying to fucking melt his fucking palace, but she can't. She has to steal a special weapon.
Yes.
Which he does. And, and then she uses most of the fuel to make a vagina. I don't know if you ever asked her. Yeah, she makes a hole for them, but it's in the fucking the inside of what the vagina looks like. So they crawl into the hole. And then Freeze beats them pretty easy. He freezes a lot of them.
Chasing Amy on her. Yeah, he does. Yeah.
Freeze handles them. He feeds them dinner and shit. And he tells them about Nora, right? And they're Harley's oh, that's bullshit. So they break out of his ice and she breaks Nora out. And he's he just froze her just like he did me. And then she's oh, I'm out. Which only means that you found a cure for my rare blood disease. And Harley's oh shit. he wasn't lying.
Right. Yeah.
And she's I have this friend that can probably help her, which is Poison Ivy, because she was a doctor.
Yeah.
At one point before she became Poison Ivy.
Right.
They cure her, but it has to be in the death of Mr. Freeze.
Yes.
So he dies. So I was oh, that kind of sucks. But then Nora becomes a character and she goes off crazy sexual awakening. Yeah. She starts fucking guys all over the place.
In this show, it's almost kind of good if a character you dies, because that's their nice way of being okay, we're putting them aside, because
they really didn't disrespect Mr. Freeze. No, honestly, they really didn't.
All due respect to Mr. Freeze.
Yeah,
but then we get in season 3 too. Your guy comes out, Swamp.
Yeah, which is why I kind of wanted to mention Nora first, or her coming out in season 2. They make a trip to New Orleans and she visits them because she misses them, and her and fucking Swamp Thing start fucking.
Yeah.
He's he was inside of me and it was special. Yeah. It's
Swamp Thing with a man bun.
Yeah, the man bun.
Much a Matthew McConaughey type character, hippie-ish.
But I was man, it's so cool. I was man, fucking Swamp Thing. I love Swamp Thing. I love the fucking lore around it.
I feel they let the creators of this show, AA, play with whatever was finally in the DC toy bag, right?
Finally,
yeah,
they were
go for it. You know what I mean? And I was okay, cool. What? I don't know. I mean,
and it kind of showed Swamp Thing's power. If he's really pissed, what he can do. It's pretty fucking scary what Swamp Thing can do.
I just asked AA. I said, is the green a real thing? And then he goes, yeah, that's a real thing from the comics. And I was okay, because again, my Swamp Thing lore is a little thin or whatever besides the movies. So I was okay, that's pretty cool. How much things they incorporate that are actual things.
It's not really the guy. It's somehow his consciousness was absorbed by the green, and it kind of made Swamp Thing. He thinks he's Alec Holland, but he's really not. Alec Holland really died. He absorbed the consciousness of Alec Holland.
So he's always been a part of the swamp or whatever. That's pretty cool. I like that. I like that.
But it's pretty scary when he's at full power and pissed off. It's almost like Mossman. You know what Mossman can do from He-Man, Master of the Universe.
Yeah. Joe says, now that's a callback to the comics. They were
Abby Arcane about fucking a planet. Which Harley and Poison Ivy are both grossed out at whenever she's we were inside each other. What the fuck?
And there's a lot of jokes about that too, right? Early on in season 1, where she keeps saying that Batman fucks bats. And then later on when
I knew the rumors are true.
Yeah, I think it's at the beginning of season 3 or whatever, with they talk about Ratcatcher.
Yeah, Ratcatcher.
She's
Oh,
is that guy fucking a rat? And she's oh man, that's fucked up or whatever. It's a lot of jokes that, but then there's a lot, other jokes.
Yeah, and then Constantine comes out too in that episode Swamp Thing, which is the actual guy that played Constantine on the show.
Is that right?
Yes.
That's fucking great. I bet these people, the producers and the writers, directors, they probably went to those people first. Hey, would you want to do the voice of Michael Ironside? Would you want to do it first?
That guy has actually been Constantine a few times already.
Really?
He came on when you were doing that whole crisis when they got everyone back.
Okay.
He was Constantine, I think, again.
I wonder if he's the voice in the anime.
I think he's done some voice work too. So he really hasn't given up on the whole thing either.
That's great.
People loved him on the show. They thought he looked great. They thought he was way better than Keanu. you know, and so I was like, well, shit, I mean, if that's your guy, you know,
keep I know when I saw him, and I, of course, obviously, I'm with the comic book character, so I was like, oh, well, the look is there, you know what I mean?
And they said it's more of the Constantine attitude.
Okay.
It's not like the Keanu Reeves. It's more like him kind of fucking over his partners, kind of shit like that.
Okay.
The you know, his fucking con artist, you know, kind of here and there being a con artist,
yeah,
there, you know, and, you know, kind of using all that kind of shit.
See, when you use Keanu Reeves, you can't put him in a role like that because it's just not believable.
That movie's so good, though. That movie is so, like, movie. If you didn't know anything about Constantine,
and
movie,
I didn't,
that movie is really good. And apparently, that's based off one of Garth Ennis's stories.
That's actually
based off one of Garth's run on the character, which I got to try and get.
Yeah, that'd be a good one, definitely, to read. Joseph, dude, Swamp Thing is the shit. Can't wait for Guns.
I can't wait. Yeah. That's one of the projects I was really excited about. I mean, I know you are, too.
I love Swamp Thing. Oh, yeah. I started it, but wherever I was watching the show at, it was it cut out all the fucking cuss words,
which
whatever.
When she told me
that's when I bought the Blu-ray or whatever, but I was disappointed because it didn't come with the fucking digital copy. So I've yet to like restart it or whatever, but I definitely do want to watch my way through it. I love Swamp Thing. I need to get those movies. I think they're kind of hard to come by.
Really?
I don't know that I've ran into them like on Blu-ray or anything. Huh. So if anybody knows.
The Wes Craven one, I know for sure. I didn't think that was going to be an issue. Sure.
There's a Wes Craven Swamp Thing?
Yeah, he's the one that directed the first one.
The original,
yeah,
really. I didn't know that. No shit. Yeah, pretty sweet.
And then I know they have the show, I know they have the two movies and a show.
I remember I liking that show too. I thought that show was
pretty cool.
And then there was a cartoon,
that's right.
That was a cartoon because they made toys.
Man, he's kind of
the Swamp Thing is in the he definitely did better than Man Thing. Blow up,
and that kind of sucks too because I mean, Man Thing was from everything I've read, Man Thing was the first,
really.
Just there was something about Swamp Thing that, well, Alan Moore. Helping, Alan Moore. You know, Alan Moore helping the fucking character more.
Plus, I think Swamp Thing makes you think of the swamp. Man Thing, you're like, what the fuck is that? Man Thing makes you think about maybe Man like
thing,
a dick.
Right? It's kind of like Man Thing. Man Thing. You know, it's kind of like, yeah, I don't know.
We might call your Johnson that. Be like, this is my man
thing. Man
thing.
Yeah. Man, maybe that's
too many Harley Quinn episodes to get your mind in the gutter there. Man Thing. Joe says, Alan Moore, Swamp Thing, book 5253. Greening of Gotham. You know, I think I actually bought those, Joe, based on your suggestion from an old episode where you first joined us on. So I have those there. I have yet to read them, but I think I have those issues at home.
I started my own, but Alan Moore has like a shitload. But I do have the first volume.
That's great, right there.
Of him when he first started the run.
Who does the art? That's great art.
It's actually the one from Miracle Man.
Is that right?
Let's see.
Stellar art,
John Totobin, and Rick. I can't really see it.
Let me see.
Right there,
Veitch.
I think
V-I-T-C-H.
So. But these were his guys with Miracle Man, and I don't even remember those issues. The art for Miracle Man were
pretty gritty.
Yeah,
gritty stuff.
You can kind of see it here.
Oh yeah, that looks great.
Right.
What's this trade called?
This is the Alan Moore, the Saga of Swamp Thing, Book One, which they actually do. Put book one for the Alan Moore arcs.
Okay.
And I think he has 6 or 7 volumes of Swamp Thing. But I mean, this run that he does is usually considered, man, one of his very best runs. I mean, they say he really does a whole revamping of the Swamp Thing lore. I mean, a lot of the shit that they use for Swamp Thing is from his era.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they say this is like one of the best runs in comic books. If you ever get it, it's going to be one of the best runs.
Nice.
That it really connects him to the green. You find out more about that, you know, and all that kind of shit. And, you know, Constantine obviously makes his first appearance in this series.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So, I mean,
I think we're definitely going to see a resurgence, right?
I started and I want to get them all. I want to get all the Alan Moore era stuff. But yeah, it's a very cool, like the covers.
That's a
like,
great really cover, man. Cool. I love that Swamp Thing look, man.
So, and this one has issues 20 through 27.
You know, I always liked the show because I felt like they made him look more like the comic than they did in that first movie where he looked more like latexy.
Yes.
Man.
Yes.
Joe says, Batman gets beat down. That makes it a win.
Yeah,
right
he really does.
I want to read that. You know, he says, hell yeah, regarding Swamp Thing. He says, badass AA regarding the graphic. And then he says, fucking Swamp Thing goes to hell to fight for Abby. Man, Dude, Swamp Thing is a fucking badass, dude.
That's what I'm saying.
I got like, that great big multiverse figure. I gotta bring it. Did I show it to you?
No, you gotta show it.
I gotta bring it to you.
You
gotta show it. Gorgeous, man. I love that thing. I was like, I want to get a second one so I could take it out.
Like I said, when I found out Swamp Thing was in like one of the episodes, I mean, I was like, blew a nut. I was like, well, man, that's fucking,
you know,
awesome.
And I wanted to tell you way back when I started season three because I was like, oh man, he's gonna lose. But I knew you hadn't caught up yet, and I was like, I'll just leave it or whatever, you know, because I never want to like spoil it for someone.
Which I mean, it would have been okay. Yeah, told me that it would have been fine.
Yeah.
I would have been like, oh, badass.
And the way you said I felt about Clayface, I was worried about you. I was like, oh, man, they might not like
the man bun. The man bun was kind of fucking stupid. But, I mean, it showed how cool he can be
right.
in this cartoon.
Right.
You know, where they're like, holy shit. Like, he's making the swamp, like, really fucking terrifying.
And I like, too, that they kind of tied him and Ivy together. I was like, oh, that's cool.
Yes, like, which I was
should,
like,
they
somebody
know each other,
somebody
right?
fucking connected those dots. You know, that, well, Poison Ivy... It's kind of like Swamp Thing too. Mm-hmm. Well, let's make her part of that shit too. So I was like, kudos on that.
I totally dug it. There we go.
CM's very badass Poison Ivy figure, which I didn't even know he had.
Courtesy of Chris Rizzo. Actually, I was in an auction with Rizzo and he won that. And then he handed it over to me. He said it to me in the mail.
Oh, this is a Bombshell line.
Yeah. He said, hey man, I'm gonna you know what? He didn't even tell me. It came in the mail, and I was like, hey, Rizzo, I think the guy sent me your figure on accident because I know you won that auction. He goes, nah, man, I wanted you to have it. So huge shout-out to Mr. Chris Rizzo, Invincible Comics.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I've always loved Poison Ivy. Just a great character.
Doing good things, yeah.
And she could really fuck up shit up if she really wanted to. You know?
Yeah, and I have to admit, this show really opened my eyes to her and how like cool she was. Oh, and I was like, oh, her powers are really badass.
She's brutal. And then, like I said, I told my wife, I was like, yeah, she was a doctor too before this too. She was like a doctor, like, you know, with botanists and and toxins. I think she knew about all that kind of shit. So.
So really, it's like two smart babes together.
Yeah,
you know
two doctors.
I mean? Like two doctors. Yeah. You know what I mean? So. And again, we're telling you guys a lot of the jokes and stuff like that, but there's so much more like plot and story that's in the show that you still watch it and enjoy it. And again, like I said, the jokes are so fast and so tight.
The shit with Ivy is like, what the fuck? You know, like Harley's like, man, he's so fucking lame and he sucks. And
yeah,
man, Kite Man does suck. He's funny as hell though. But I was like, how the fuck is he banging Poison Ivy?
And you even feel like she knows he sucks. You know,
and then
they
keep going on and on about his great chili, about how fucking his chili tastes like great. Yeah. And then they meet his parents at a Mexican restaurant. They have powers and he doesn't. And he can't even get like reservations because he sucks. You know.
And I got to admit, though, when I watched it the first time through, I was curveballed by the Ivy Harley hookup. I was kind of like, oh,
really?
What the fuck? I was like, wow. I don't think I saw that coming. Okay. And then I thought it was like, oh, it's just a joke for the one episode or whatever, the one time. And then like when it carried on, I was like, oh, wow, they're running with this. This is cool or whatever.
Yeah, so they have a bachelorette party at like the Amazonian island and like her and Harley like fuck like two times.
Yeah.
Where it was supposed to be like
her bachelorette party.
With like Nora, an old childhood friend of like Ivy's that she hasn't even spoken to in a long time, and a Catwoman, I think. And they were like, what the fuck? Like,
yeah, this is a great question from Friday Nighter Joe, also of the Now Watch This podcast. Joe says, so guys, hypothetically, who do you wife up, Ivy or Harley?
Ivy.
Double A is definitely an Ivy guy.
I'm a big Poison
I gotta
Ivy
say,
fan.
I want to say Ivy in my heart, but I think that I might.
I think CM like, would love like to have a woman like Harley that just like tries to impress him so much.
Yeah, and I think also too, like Ivy likes to sit at home a little too much for me. Although I really like her intelligence, I'm attracted to that. But
yeah,
I really
want
to
be with the action.
I want to be in the action with Harley. Like I'm gonna be like, all right, let's fuck some shit up. You know what I mean? So, Joe, what's your answer? Friday Nighters, what's your answer? You know what, Joe? That's such a great question. I'm gonna make that the poll question tonight.
All right.
Who do you wife up? You know what I mean? And it goes for guys.
Who would
get girls.
Your poll up?
Yeah. Who would? Get, yeah. we're totally immersed in the Harley Quinn humor right now. Damn, is this an episode of Not Watch This? Joe says, Chuck couldn't understand why his pants were tenting while watching Harley. Yeah, definitely. Strange things happening. And he also says, It's the Nightwing factor that takes Chuck to Harley. It probably is, knowing that Nightwing was with her in the other movie, the side movie. That's a good one to watch.
Which one is it?
It's called Batman and Harley Quinn.
Oh, that one. Okay.
It's solid.
That was really good. First movie it was recommending after like the season was over.
Yeah.
It was recommending that one to watch.
Next. I watched that one and had a fun time with it. Because okay. Nightwing's pretty prominent or whatever. Is I it? Don't love his hair in that one, but yeah. No, it just has a kind of more cropped. I like when it has kind of like a more I liked his hair in this one.
Yeah.
Better. Yeah. So which, you know, I mean, I kind of wear my hair kind of cropped like that. So it's like, you know, but definitely Joe. And I think that might have been a Joe suggestion. I think I watched that off of Joe's suggestion, the Batman Harley Quinn one. Okay. I really loved it. He's this dude when Harley sings in that one.
Who does the voice of Harley in that one? You know?
I don't know. Joe, that'd be good to know. It's good. Yeah. It reminded me of the original, I think. So it may have been her, to be honest with you.
What do you think of fucking Billy Bob Thornton?
Is it his voice?
I think it is.
I mean, I thought that shit was hilarious. That was like a fucking funny ass pull to be him.
And then how he says his name, William Robert Thornton.
Yeah, William Robert Thornton. Yeah, I was like, what the fuck?
But it is Thomas Wayne and Clayface fucking taking his life over.
Oh, so the voice of Harley in the one we're talking about is that Melissa Rauch, who's the what's his name's chick in
Big Howard.
Howard's chick, yeah. Yeah. That's her first thing that comes up. Her claim to fame is that. And she's in the new Night Court. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's funny how Big Bang Theory isn't her first thing or whatever. Bernadette.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. And I heard she's getting praised for the new Night Court as well. Yeah, I loved her. I had never seen
Night Court. I'd never seen that show. I don't know how good it was.
I used to watch it. Like
they said at one point, John Larroquette was so fucking funny in that show that he was winning all the Emmys like every year until the point where he had to like get his name off. He told them get his name off because he had won like four or five straight.
I thought like when I saw this preview for this new one that he was in it, I was like, "Oh shit, he came back! That's pretty cool."
And then I heard she's supposed to be the daughter of Harry Anderson's character.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So. Why didn't he come back? Is he dead?
He's dead. Oh, what? Yeah, he died a long time ago. Yeah.
Man, that's fucking terrible news.
Yeah, he's been dead for.
I didn't know that. That's cool. Yeah. That's really cool.
Yeah. So,
let's see.
Billy Bob is himself, and we also have Frankie Muniz actually played himself too, and Howie Mandel and George Lopez did too when he was doing his comedy bit at the pit when they put him in jail in the pit.
That's fucking great. I didn't know that. Dude, I love that Howie segment when they're like, "Holy shit, not Howie!" and Joker's got him all strapped with bombs. Joe says the other chick from Big Bang Theory. Joe, good pull. You were right on time, sir. And then he says, there's a Batman dance in that as well. And then he also says, Jerry Davila did a Night Court episode last year. Got me rewatching. Nice. Oh, very nice.
Where can you rewatch Night Court?
Yeah, Joe, where can you rewatch that?
Huh? Yeah, I was like, is there a place?
I'm sure Joe will give you a place to rewatch.
Yeah, because I like John Larroquette.
Not only that, I think you'd like it doubly because you like shows of that time.
Yeah.
So I think that it would really appeal to you. I remember watching it too, like, the same way that I would watch Nick at Night, you know what I mean? And I'd watch My Three Sons and Dobie Gillis and Gilligan's Island. I would watch that sometimes, and sometimes with my dad, and then just sometimes about myself because I just thought, like, I liked Bull. You know, Bull from Night Court, because he was the bailiff or whatever.
Yes.
And then he was from House.
Yes.
I was like, oh, the guy from House or whatever, which I thought he was scary in the movie House. You know
he is.
The real House, not the one about that. Don't ask Doctor. You know what I mean? Yeah. Which my sister loves that doctor, the Doctor really? House one. Yeah, that's what she likes. Right. Yeah. She likes a lot of shit. Like, she likes like an SVU and crime shit.
Those shows after a while, man, they get to me.
Oh man, that's a lot.
Yeah, I went to visit my mom because she was feeling bad the other day, and they were watching the ID channel, and I was just like, I tell my mom, I don't know how you watch these shows. I was like, I can only watch like two or three before it's like it gets to me, like it fucks me up in the head. Like I was like, I don't know how you were listening to those morbid podcasts. I was like, all the details and everything going in there. I was
And that's that. Those two gals kind of spare you some stuff, but you know what it was? Double A was that like the scenario was so interesting.
I know it is interesting, but it's like after a while, it's like you actually do feel like that Will Graham kind of character. Yes. Like, he's like, oh, he can't do it anymore.
I want to tell you, I've given it a huge break. I haven't heard it in a while. I'm behind a bunch of because, yeah, it was really like, it's pretty grisly. You know? Yeah. It gets pretty grisly. And I was like, yeah, I need to like all through the holiday season, I was like, I haven't heard it since like then. I need to clear my mind.
Yeah, because it was like, it was a classic story. The girlfriend, you know, usually it's always a girlfriend or a husband or a husband and wife. You know, she was cheating. The dude found out. He fucking killed her pretty nasty. Just dumped her body in the river. And it's like, whew, man, I was like, it gets you. Like, it gets you to see how they caught the dude and everything. But yeah, after a while, after watching so many of those shows, it's like, I can't watch these anymore.
Dude, when I heard their Night Stalker one and how close other Richard people got Harris. To killing that fucker, like there was like, I think the one lady came out, I think he did rape, but she came out with a shotgun, but it wasn't loaded. So it was like, she literally had him dead to rights, but it wasn't loaded. So of course, like everything that piece of shit got, like he deserved, when they chased him through the streets, they beat the fuck out of him. I was like, well, that's great. We took a turn, double A.
That happens when you go into the mind of Harley Quinn.
Exactly. I'm telling you, Joe says Prime has the series.
Amazon Prime.
Night Court.
Okay. There. All right. Yeah, because like I said, I love John Larkin. He's fucking
hilarious.
Funny.
Yeah. You know? And it's Harry Anderson, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he's great.
Richie.
Too.
Richie.
From yes. Yeah. And that's where I knew him from, was from Night Court. I was like, oh, the guy from Night Court or whatever.
And he comes out a lot on the Tales from the Dark Side. Like, if you ever rewatch those, he comes out on a few of those episodes.
Yes. Too. Yeah. That's Tales from the Crypt, too.
And Tales from the Crypt.
He's the artist.
Yeah. One of the artists. And then, like you said, I think I mentioned before, but John Larroquette does the narration for Texas Chainsaw Massacre. You know, so that's
right. You that's have said that. Cool, yeah. Man. That's fucking crazy to think about. Let's bring it back around, double A, to Harley Quinn. Any other moments or things that kind of stand out? Again, guys, we can't suggest this show.
It's just fucking fun. I mean, like I said, like, they even make Nora a damn character, Nora Freeze.
Yeah.
It's like, what the fuck, you know? You know, them going into the head of, like, Harley, there's, like, one episode where, like, she completely, like, breaks down and she, like, I don't know, she, like, freezes. You know, where she can't take anymore, like, of the questioning, and like Dr. Psycho has everyone like going to her brain, but it's like, you gotta hold hands, you gotta pucker your ass, they all go into her brain,
and they bring back that back in season 3. But I remember laughing right away when we first catch up with him again, and he's like, I'm here doing my podcast,
he's a podcaster. I was like, man, Dr. Psycho has like a really badass podcast where he's trying to help people heal, and you got like Bane's like one of the callers, Bizarro's one
Bizarro.
Of the callers, Maxwell Lord is the other one.
I read the other one. I was able to kind of like look and read it. I paused it because I was like, who's the other name? I can't remember who it is right now. But it was fucking funny or whatever.
And then he stops Bane from talking and he starts doing an ad. And he does it really badass, and they fucking interrupt him because they need his help.
You know? I'm sure our fellow podcasting fans at podcasts, I guess, were all like, oh, damn, look at him delivering that that ad right there. He's killing it right there.
And he even gets mad too because he was like, man, that was a really good clean, like, read.
Clean read,
He's like, I got to get you on my show.
Yeah, he's trying to get all these guests, which I was like, oh, damn, can we relate, right? That's a great guest. Yeah, guys, so it's like, I didn't know double A, but they're kind of including the Valentine special with season 3 because they call it episode 11. Too. I felt like it was a standalone.
Too. I thought it was too, because I mean, it's really different.
It wraps up, what do you call it, the season, or like episode 10 kind of wraps up that season.
Yeah, it wraps up that whole season. So yeah, I was kind of surprised too when I saw season 3 episode 11. I was like, oh, okay, well, I don't know why that was, but
yeah. But it's a fast watch. It's 22-minute episodes. Mm-hmm. They're so fucking funny. You're going to laugh at it.
It's like, my wife has no clue about like the DC universe. Like, she barely found out a little bit about the Marvel universe, right? I mean, barely, because of the movies. Because when we started getting together, you know, that's when the whole Marvel shit was happening.
Right.
DC, I mean, she's like everyone else who knows Superman, the Batman movies, you know, but I mean, not really, not too much.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, you've seen them, but like, you're
if
not
you
would have
seen Bane, she wouldn't even know what the fuck, who the fuck Bane is. You know, she knows Catwoman, obviously, from the show. She thinks Penguin looks like, you know, the fucking Batman Returns Penguin. I was like, you know, that's not the way he really looks. You know, I don't know why Tim Burton changed him that much, but I was like, no, he doesn't really look that way. But like, to her, those are like the character, the representations, the look of the characters based on the Tim Burton movies and the Schumacher movies, you know. So that's her, and that's what she thinks. So with all these characters, you know,
and that's how huge those movies were, right? The way it's so impactful, like everyone that saw it, they're like, oh, well, that's how it is.
Exactly. So she knows that much, you know. She knows, like, she only knows Superman and Lex Luthor. She wouldn't even know. She wouldn't even tell you who the fuck General Zod is or Darkseid. Oh, right. She wouldn't. She didn't even know who Darkseid is. Like, we think Darkseid's like, no, she doesn't even know, but she was watching this and she was just fucking laughing her ass off.
Oh yeah.
You know, she was like, this is fucking funny. She kept going on and on saying Seth Green must have written this show because it has like chicken, like that robot chicken, like kind of like
kind of humor. Humor right?
And she kept going on and then it must have been Seth Green writing this. I don't know. I go, it's not Seth Green, but it's like obviously someone that fucking, you know, saw the animated series, follows the DC universe, and pulled these fucking random characters like Dr. Psycho out of their ass, you know, and to make them fucking funny again, you know, and it's just humor. Like, she really loved it, you know. I mean, she thought this was the funniest fucking cartoon she's ever seen.
It makes me inspired to want to maybe like show the girlfriend a few episodes, see if I can get her to get laughing.
Because obviously she knows Harley. Day episode. I mean, my wife was and the night of the court of owls.
Joe says, waiting on the kid to get to sleep so he can watch the Valentine special. We'll try not to
spoil it. Yeah, you need to, Joe, because you need to wait. Yeah,
because he says, damn it, don't let anything. The dark side is the Thanos.
And that was the thing, Joe, too. Like, I tried telling my, like, anybody, too, that listens. I'm like, I go, that's the fucking thing about Marvel kind of winning the race is that people are going to think Darkseid's going to be a fucking Thanos ripoff. When it's actually the other way around. Like, they've actually admitted it. Like, Marvel actually has admitted, or Stanley told Jim Starlin, now, if you're going to make a big bad, at least base it off Darkseid. Not because he was basing it on some other new god, and he was like, man, not that guy. He was like, make it based on that on Darkseid.
You know? I mean, shit, we forgot about that, right? With what's her name?
Granny Goodness?
Granny Goodness. Yeah. She gets her brains bashed. She
fucking gets her ass kicked. Yeah, I was like, damn.
I'm just thinking of all the great moments that are in this Harley Quinn series, like with all the great like characters that come out.
Now, you know, I was going to say something about the Valentine's Day, but Joe hasn't even seen it, because that part that he's on is fucking funny, too.
Yes, yes. Really great, really great. Yeah, Joe, you'll totally appreciate the Valentine's
They pull out Darkseid.
Watch it with the wife.
Joe. They pull out Luther. They pull out Sinestro. They even, I think Black Adam's even in the fucking one of the episodes.
Is that right?
I think he is. I mean, Sinestro's there. He's like in the background. Sinestro's like in the background with the Billy talking with what's her name? The Wonder Woman's main one. Cheetah.
Yes, Cheetah. Yeah,
he's talking with her. And you got like Clock King, which I was like, man, the Clock King could actually be like the fucking Clock King. You know, him and Riddler are fucking like lovers. And, you know, Clayface falling in love with his own ass. You know, you got Penguin, you got Two-Face. I mean, you got like the whole Bat family in there.
Even Harley getting a hold of the Lasso of Truth or whatever.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
She goes to Wonder Woman.
I love when she's like, thanks, Cameo, the best $300 I ever spent or whatever. Yeah. Like, oh, I got, you know,
the Queen, the mom.
The Queen of the Mascara to record a video. You know what I mean? Let me see. Joe also says, he says, I thought they had. I thought they had some of it in Titans too. Excuse me, Joe. The Darkseid stuff, is that what you're referring to, Joe? Let us know what you're talking about there. That's
You know, Mr. Miracle, which, you know, that's a character you don't fucking see, even if it's just for that little bit where he gets bashed in the head by Harley.
Yes.
Like, that's fucking cool. I mean, you know, I mean, you got the Justice League, you got some of them, you got John. Yeah, I think he did get John. You got Wonder Woman, you got Superman in here, Lois.
I mean, they bring back.
They mentioned the Phantom Zone. In.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, Luther's in there. I mean, it's just Black Manta, which,
right?
You know, they're like, where like Catwoman goes, yeah, you know, you're giving me this award because I'm black, and you know, you've always had Black Manta over there, and Joker's like, Black Manta's black. And then she leaves, like, because she's all pissed off, and Black Manta stands up and starts clapping.
Yeah, nice. Which is, you know, again, the Joker is Alan Tudyk, who we all know
from. Yeah, which, like, I was surprised when Sam told me. I was like, wow.
Yeah, I always think about him like in a live action movie from Dodgeball. You know, he's Dodgeball the Pirate Steve or whatever, you know, but also he's K2SO on Rogue One.
Yep.
I mean, like,
310 to Yuma, be like 310 to Yuma.
That's right, he's in there too. 310 to Yuma, yeah. I didn't get to really, we were talking about King Shark earlier. We talked about how it's Stallone and Suicide Squad. And then in the game, it's going to be Samoa Joe, great wrestler who we love. In this one, it's a comedian, Ron Funches. He's very funny. The voice he does for him is very funny for King Shark. I kind of had like a little love-hate relationship with Ron Funches because I thought he was funny, but then I heard he came to San Antonio and he didn't get a lot of laughs, and that he like really like shat on San Antonio. But I think that I don't think he knew his audience, because I was like, his comedy, I don't think would be for like a comedy club in San Antonio. I was like, he has a very specific, dry, nuanced type of humor. And I'm like, if you just go to like an open mic at San Antonio Comedy Club, you're not going to get, I could have told him that. I'm like, his agent is shit. Then I'm like, or just know your audience, know your regions or whatever. In San Antonio, George Lopez will sell out the fucking AT&T Center or whatever.
Yeah.
But that's not everywhere. Even Seinfeld is huge, but Seinfeld comes here and he doesn't play the AT&T Center. He plays, you know, the Majestic or whatever, which is like the size for Seinfeld here in San Antonio. You have to know your audience.
Yeah, you have to. Yeah.
So let me see here. Joe says, know some Titan references on Harley. Nice. Yes. And then he says, no one is off limits. Totally agree on that. But Ron Funches, I would give him all the credit in the world because he does do a great job.
Yeah, he was great. Shark. He was great. As King Shark. Like Lopez even shit on San Antonio. I mean, that's
right. Exactly. Yeah. Not like he's Mr. SA because he's a California guy. Like,
they're comedians. I mean, right. You know, they're going to be mad if, you know, you got some fucking town that's laughing your ass off. But in this town, you're like, no one's laughing. You're like, wow. You know,
yeah, and I think I heard the comments he said about us were because he was trying to pump up the next town or whatever. So you're the next town, you're like, oh, you're better than them, than that other town or whatever. You just named the town you were at before.
It's fine. They're comedians. It's fine.
Whatever. You know what I mean?
He was fucking funny as King Shark. I liked him as King Shark.
Yeah.
It's funny that him and Clayface are like best friends and he kept fucking biting everyone's head off. And,
yeah.
You know,
I love the scene with him and his brother, the other shark, and he's like, saying, he's like, I was here when dad would be shitting his diapers. He's like, and we shit in the water. We just shit wherever we want. Like, I just started laughing. I was like,
yeah, then he even makes a toilet.
Yeah. I was like, what the fuck, man?
Yeah, because he's like disgusted that everyone just shits freely in the ocean.
And what's funny too, right, is that they write in jokes like that, right? They're like about like the real animal, whatever. He's like, oh, you know
like the Little Mermaid team? That they had, like what the fucking crab was singing. And
oh my gosh, like Little Mermaid. I was fucking laughing. Dude, or even when he references like the two dicks, he's like, oh, you're just going to walk around swinging your two dicks. And you're like, oh yeah, sharks do have two dicks. Which is like, it's just like a random ass fact. Like, you're like, why did he say that? And then you have to think about it. And if you like ever read that dumbass fact, you're like, oh, I remember it now.
The blood, when they have Damien hanging upside down, like it turns into a real fucking shark.
Yeah.
Nah, he was great. They were all fucking funny. They were great. I mean,
they really like lean into their characters.
Like, it's characters that I just wouldn't even give a shit. Like, if you had told me Dr. Psycho was going to be in here, I'd be like, who? Shark, you know, King Shark? Like, what the fuck? Like, Suicide Squad? You know, like, it doesn't work, but I don't know. It just somehow works in this fucking stupid cartoon.
It really, really works. I think this cartoon is highly underrated.
It really is.
I think everyone should watch it. Like, I want to get my sister to watch it. I want to get my girlfriend to watch
it. She will love it. I think they'd
be laughing their ass off. Like, it's fucking hilarious.
I think they would really like it a lot. I mean, it has so many people in here. It has so many fucking cool cameos in here.
I was so blown away.
Surprised DC let him have this many characters.
Exactly. And they just let him too kind of like write a lot of this stuff the way they wrote it or whatever, because they take a big shit on a lot of like, you know, beloved characters, and you're like, ooh. But they're just like, eh, whatever. Maybe they thought nobody was going to watch it. They're like, eh, it'll be fine. Just let them do whatever they want.
Maybe.
Let's see. Joe also says here, he says, His voice fit Shark surprisingly. Oh, yeah. Ron Funches' voice. Yeah, the voice he gave him where it's kind of like intelligent, but, you know, like.
Okay, so I want to read something real quick. So yeah, it says audience viewership. It says, according to Real Good, I don't know who that is, but it must be someone, all right. Harley Quinn has ranked among the top 30 comic book TV shows across all streaming services.
I dig it.
According to an analytics, since the pandemic began, the series has ranked among the top 10 most in-demand digital series in 5 months and ranked as HBO Max's 8th most in-demand series overall domestically. Not too fucking bad. That's so not too bad at all. People are coming in. Yeah. You know?
No, definitely. I mean, that's great.
The first season from Rotten Tomatoes got an 89%, and then season 2 and 3 have 100%.
Holy shit.
So, I mean.
That's impressive.
Right?
Right? I mean, especially with those guys where you hear people be like, you know.
But I think the relationship has been so old already. You know what I mean? Like the poison, that's not forced on. That's already been there for a long time already.
But, you know, it's just funny, right, Double D? Because we always hear about like the review bombing. That's like the new thing. Like, like before something. I mean, I'm not going to, I will admit this. Like, I really love that, you know, and I think we still have Joe here with us from his podcast Now Watch This. And he had some really good things. He said that, you know, like, I think if I'm correct, maybe if I'm wrong, Joe, but he had said that, you know, he thought that Black Adam was a fun watch. I'm like, it's a fun action popcorn flick. Me and you don't normally cover something unless we like it. Me and you were in the theater together. You're with your wife. I was with my family. You know, we got it. And like I said, I literally embraced you because I was like, dude, I like that movie. I thought that was a fucking fun movie. I would watch that movie again. It was action. It was like, it made me kind of think Double A of like Masters of the Universe. When I was a kid, after I saw Masters of the Universe, I said, this is the best movie I've ever seen. I mean, I was like, I was, you know, what? Nine,
eight, nine. Like, hey, look, you know, that ending.
It's fine.
You know,
oh my gosh,
if they don't come back.
No, that's that ending. I'm fine. I pop hard on that.
I'm fine with that. You know, I'm fine if they never ever make a movie with those two again. I'm fine. I'm just glad I was able to see that. You know, it's in the
action. I'm not glad though. Like, I feel ripped off that I didn't get the rest of that story. I was like,
it's funny. There is actually a spinoff coming called Noonan's, the bar. And it's going to feature Kite Man and his current girlfriend, Golden Glider, that's being developed.
Oh,
so,
wow.
So Kite Man.
Now, sometimes you might be going to the well too much. Right? You know what? I love Killer Croc. Killer Croc was, and the gal from the first Suicide Squad, that demon chick or whoever she was, whatever. I thought that was pretty cool.
I need a Bane series. That's what I need.
That's the spinoff I would have done, was the Bane spinoff. Yeah. And have Clayface in there come out too.
He's so fucking heavily focused on this in this cartoon. Like, someone really loves Bane. I mean, this was the second important story of the Valentine's Day special.
I'm telling you, I feel like they were like, oh my gosh, that voice from the Nolan one is so good. We can't let up on that. And they just rode with it. And he's a hybrid of like what we know of the real Bane. And then he's like the fucking voice of the Tom Hardy.
Which is great. I love that so much. I love how they copy Tom Hardy.
Yes, I thought it was fucking hilarious. His
deliveries are great.
Very great deliveries, man. Yeah, like everyone, that's something everyone does too. Like all the punchlines are good or whatever. Like all the I'm telling you, the jokes are tight. They're fast and furious. Like, it's like, and I love that too, because that's a lot of like the humor that I love from Futurama, is that the humor is like, it's like back to back to back to back. You know what it reminds me of, Double A? Huh. Like, to relate to it, it's like chain wrestling. When you watch guys go through a big sequence and you're like, holy fuck, that was amazing. And some people are like, oh, they don't like that. I know, like, I don't think Flair really likes that, right? Like, Flair has said he's like not a big fan of chain wrestling, I think. I could be incorrect, but
it could be.
I feel like the Mexican wrestlers do it a lot. And I'm like, it makes for a great show because it's like reverse. That's like when you watch like Osprey and Ricochet, it's like, it gets you hyped because you're like that. And I think that in many ways, and I have often, you can fucking quote me on this. I have said the two greatest and hardest performing arts are, I would say, A, professional wrestling, and B, comedy. And I would say that because professional wrestling is number one because there's a physical aspect to it. And comedy, though, no, there's not. But you have to be about your wits. Like, you have to be like, it's everything is like with comedy. And that's exactly what I think about when I think about wrestling. Like, I think the two are very closely related. I mean, like, Dolph Ziggler used to date Amy Schumer. I'm sure they had a lot to talk about regarding, like, delivery. Because it's like, it's the same thing. You're delivering or whatever. And there you have two people that are like, Dolph Ziggler, what did we talk about? One of the greatest sellers, Amy Schumer or whatever. It's like, you know, one of the, you know, few really like overly successful female comedians or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, and again, I love her stand-ups. I've heard her, and it's like, it's so sharp. The deliveries, whatever, just like when you watch Dolph, like his drop kicks are good. It's like, you know, his selling is really good or whatever. And I'm like, there's a lot between comedy and professional wrestling or whatever.
I don't know if you ever I saw a clip where she said that she couldn't really keep up with him.
Yes, I heard that
in
too.
In a bed because he's too fucking athletic.
Yes. Well, I mean, come on. Even now, we've always known Dolph is fucking shredded.
She was like, I just, I'm usually like, like just being able to be the one to do the things and the guy be happy with just like little things, but he's like going all over the fucking place.
Yeah, can you imagine that too? Like a guy, number two, all you do in wrestling and work on is your cardio. So yeah, like the guy's got stamina out the ass.
Yeah, he does.
He's probably wearing her out. You know what I mean?
Yeah, he's like fucking jumping all over the place around her.
What's funny to me thinking about that now, my mind is that like other white people probably don't imagine that two white people had that kind of sex. You know what I mean? So.
Oh, there you go.
CJ Belanger in the house. He says Amy Schumer said Dolph was the most athletic banging she ever got.
Yeah, I was like, man, he probably was like flipping her all over the fucking place.
Hey, man, and then I want to say something too. I thought your Ray Lewis picture was really great. I tagged CJ in it, giving props the way I tagged you know, Lucky in the Chicago Bears picture.
Oh.
CJ said, not a fan of the Ray Lewis.
Okay.
Ravens fan, but didn't like Ray Lewis. CJ, you got to elaborate for us a little bit.
Is it because that criminal shit that happened like before the Super Bowl?
I was like, don't judge him on that. He says every fucking sports guy we know, right?
Yeah, I mean,
find me a sports guy without some fucking hefty criminal activity, and I'll be surprised. I'll tell you that shit. Maybe I was gonna say Steve Nash, but I was like, no, that motherfucker was in trouble too. I was like, nah, they're all in trouble. Who's winning the big game on Sunday, CJ? I want to hear it. He says, I didn't like the way he handled the allegations against him.
And the shit that was.
Murder was the case that they gave him. Yeah. Well, they are the dirty birds for a reason, CJ. So that's why they, you know, who's the other guy? Is it Rice? Ray Rice? Was it?
There's a
bunch in there, but you know, we stray. CJ, did you watch the Harley Quinn animated show on HBO Max? And if so, what were your standout moments from it? Did you like it? Did you love it? Did you hate it? Is it something that you would watch? I know you got little ones in the house, so you definitely can't watch it.
And this ain't like an old show. Like I said, this came out 2019.
Yeah, 2019.
The last series just wrapped up at September of last year of 2022. So, I mean, it's not that old. And then this Valentine's special just got released yesterday.
Yeah.
So it's very new.
And very relevant. And here's the thing that I thought about it when I was watching it. This is what I thought about AA. Me and you, we like Batman. Say people, everyone says what they will. We do like Batman. But I thought, in my mind, I was like, people that love Batman should love this because it's very in tune with the Batman lore and the Bat family and all that. I was like, oh, this is a, like, if you're a Batman fan, you're really going to love it.
Yeah, because like I said, it has the rogue gallery. It has the Bat family in here. Alfred's actually pretty fucking good, too.
Yes.
It's even got Lucius Fox in here.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean,
it leans heavily into everything. I mean, shit, Thomas and Martha Wayne. You know what
his
I mean?
Relationship with Catwoman. You know, yeah, it's talked about a lot. You know, so
it's like a raunchy Batman the Animated Series. Oh, man. Let's see. CJ says
Ray Lewis on Ray Lewis. He's a great player, but I won't defend him covering up a murder. And then when the family wanted him to take responsibility, he did an interview saying God doesn't make mistakes, basically absolving himself. So.
Fucking
yeah, shit. So I mean, that's I was, and don't get me wrong,
I don't even think OJ had the balls to say that.
I was kind of hesitant to put up that picture, but I'm like, if it's, you know, it's the Ravens, that team was a dominant team that you're even doing a 30 for 30 on that team.
Wow,
that Baltimore Ravens, because that defense was fucking one of the toughest defenses.
Do they win without him?
I mean, obviously, very integral. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that you know, he fucking sucked. Because you're saying he was the most dominant guy since like LT.
Yeah, I know he is. I mean, you know, the picture you put, that pose, whatever, that's literally, he has an official Instagram, and that's like the literal picture. That's him. When you see that image, you know that's him. And that's something that's hard to do. It's hard to create that or whatever. Jordan and the Jordan pose. I mean, it's hard to.
He goes, I know I haven't seen this version of Harley Quinn yet. Maybe I'll check it out this. I mean, just watch you, one episode, CJ.
CJ, you're. Like, I watched this one.
And I was like, I told TM, I was like, we gotta do this.
Yeah. If this guy loved it, Joe loves it, Lucky loves it. I know that Anthony Caruso loves it. I'm pretty sure Jerry D has seen it. So CJ, I think that you will have a very good appreciation for it, and I would love to hear your opinions about it, even if it's next week when a follow-up show or in the comments, please. I have no doubt you'll like it when the kiddos are in bed, for sure.
It's very rated R.
But interesting topic on that stuff. I mean, obviously, you know, I was a Patriots fan in the Aaron Hernandez time. I mean, you know, and it was like, fuck, you know what I mean? Like, you know, not that I was like going to go buy a jersey of him. I mean, I thought that guy was really good.
Yeah, no, he was really, really fucking good. And just, it's weird how some of those guys just can't let go of that shit. You know, that dude, you know, like really, like you're on the greatest team, like one of the greatest teams ever. You're with the playing with the greatest quarterback. You can't let that shit go.
Well, just you know like your I mean? Life period has changed. You don't live the same that life too. As them anymore. Like,
yeah, it's like, come on, man. You're on a national level. You're playing again with that at that time. It's like one of the greatest teams ever, you know, and he was making a mark for himself. Like, he really was. He was like one of the standout tight ends. And for him to do that shit, I was like, wow.
That was like a deadly duo with like them two, you know, him and Gronk or whatever. Yeah. And then like, I remember when the Patriots, like they were actually offering refunds on the jerseys. They were like, if you bought one, you could get like a full refund or swap it. And I was like,
that fucking sucked. Yeah.
Yeah. Pretty crazy. What do you think, Double A? Anything else you want to say about?
No, it's just really good. Like I said, they do a really good job of incorporating like that. If you love the Batman tree,
mm-hmm.
you're gonna love this series. Plus if you like the Justice League, it's gonna be here. The episodes are like I said, there's orgies in here, there's blood in here, there's bones in here. I mean,
yeah,
it's got like everything, but I mean it's got cool shit. Like some of the powers that they do show, some of the people having, like Poison Ivy, like Swamp Thing, like what they can do, Mr. Freeze, Two-Face, like it's pretty fucking cool. If you're a fan of the Super Friends, they got the Legion of Doom references everywhere. Like Sam said, if you're a fan of the Adam West show, they got Adam West Easter eggs all over that place. You know, I mean, it's a really fun show. And they're 22 minutes each. You know, it's 37 episodes, but they're like 22 minutes.
And yeah, it's a breeze.
I got through it, you know, from Tuesday to today.
Yeah, he crushed it. And he like shocked me. And he was like, do you want to do that? And I was like, okay. And so like I started to rewatch them. And I got through quite a bit in my rewatch, even though I was like, I'd already seen season one and two. And the first half of season three, and I just wrapped up season three, watched the Valentine special, and then I still got to watch some of the, I went back to episode one and watched a few through, and it's just like very fast, and it's so worth it because it's so
Joker
funny.
Is really good. This is great like one Joker. Of the best Jokers
it
I've
really
seen.
Is one of the best Jokers.
You know, if you're expecting to see a smart Batman, you're not going to get it here. If you're expecting to see like a great Jim Gordon, you're not going to see it here. Bane, if you think you're going to get that tactician from Dark Knight Rises, you're not going to get him here. Riddler's like an idiot too, kind of. You know what I mean? You know, it's really like the only standouts, like really like Joker, but it's fucking funny though. Like they do it in such a great way. The jokes are fucking, the singers, I mean, they're like, they get you. Yeah. You're like, what the fuck did he just say? You know, it's like, it's fucking funny.
Well,
you know?
Again, Double A, I really feel as though like it's written and it's shown in a perspective from like maybe the way outsiders look at it. We're like, come on, you didn't see that coming. It's almost like they're like, what? That's what you're doing? Like, they make fun of the shit that we know. They're like, why would you do that or whatever?
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah, they really do. They really do hit on that.
It's hilarious in that sense. And I love it. So you got to check it out. Let's see. CJ also says, regarding the Aaron Hernandez thing, Hernandez had a bad mental maturity
of a child. I don't think he was able to let it go. And he says, very unfortunate.
Yeah, no, totally. Totally. Uh-huh. Yeah, that was definitely a dark chapter.
The Valentine's Day special was the 44 minute. But I mean, it's super fast.
I didn't realize it was longer.
Yeah, you're going to love it. Like I said, Bane is fucking hilarious in that one. Clayface is fucking hilarious in that one. You know?
Yeah.
And what Harley's trying to give Ivy like the best orgasm ever. That's like her whole purpose on Valentine's Day. Their first Valentine's together, she, you know, she goes to this demon to make sure she can be a sex machine, you know, and Bane goes to, you know, Etrigan too, to get like a fucking, get his dick bigger, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's fucking ludicrous.
It is absolutely ludicrous. And I will say this too, Double A, like I popped like seeing him and I popped seeing like, you know, just like, again, like the jokes that they're doing where it's like, you know, Harley trying to get the lasso of truth, whatever.
Yeah.
You know, again, and then like I will say this, I kind of said it in the write up, whatever. It's like the show has touching moments as well too.
Yeah, yes it does.
I loved Ivy's story too. She's like, you didn't ever ask me what my best.
And like I said, like I said, with Harley when she kind of was like taking care of Bruce, you know.
Yeah, yeah, you know, that was pretty like I was kind of like, damn, you know what I mean? And again, that part's kind of dark and grim. You're like, oh shit, like you know, he has forced himself into this, you know, if I have felt anything about him in the last fucking however many years we've been doing this show. There's
like a Green Lantern issue too, where he lets him have the ring and he becomes a Green Lantern. And, you know, he's like, you can let it all go. But he's like, no, I got to keep it. That's what keeps me going.
So, right. Right. Very, very interesting. So a great show.
Three seasons.
From DC.
One special. 22-minute episodes with the 44-minute special. It's 37 episodes still.
Yeah. If you want my review, what I always say is, like, would I buy it? Would I rewatch it? I had a joy rewatching it. And I believe that the seasons are out, at least one and two, to buy. Okay. But I would want to wait until I could get all of it. Like, when I knew it was done, like I would want to get all of it at once. Yeah. That would be for me, maybe in a nice steel book, or I don't know how they would collect it, but it had to be on Blu-ray too, because I think that one and two only came out on DVD. So for me, I need to get it. Like, yeah, but would I buy it? Absolutely, I would buy it, because it's well worth having and it's great. And I hope it will come with a nice digital copy that I could download and have that as well, just in case HBO Max ever for some reason takes off DC shit. But I'm so glad it's on DC. I'm so glad AA chose this topic. I'm so glad I got to rewatch it, because I just laughed my ass off. This is a classic show that you can put on in the background, like The Office, like Parks and Rec, like Seinfeld, that you just put it on. Once you've seen it so many times, you just laugh. Excuse me, wait for the parts that you want to see that are funny. Wait for the characters that you see are funny and whatever. And again, if it's your first time, you're going to.
Yeah, man, it's got lines like, you know, like, you fuck. You miserable cunt. You know, it's like little zingers like that that you're just like, what the fuck? You know?
Yeah, everyone is just like letting it all out. And you're like, holy shit, like these are characters I know. And, you know, it really makes it great the way they did it. I didn't expect that when I first started watching it. Should anything else double it
real quick? I did forget to mention, if anyone's listening, The Last of Us is tonight.
Because
I don't think they want to
compete with the Super Bowl.
So it is on tonight. It probably already started like an hour ago,
something
so.
To watch. No, so spoilers,
it's on HBO Max, but yeah, it's coming out tonight. No, it's not gonna be on Sunday. Well, I mean, you can watch it on Sunday, but I mean, it's already out,
so yeah. we get a little.
So I'm probably gonna do that, you know, after this is.
Yeah, me too. Do that, and then I'll watch it again tomorrow, because I'm loving that show so much.
Great show.
I'm pretty sure that show is getting covered on this show.
So. Oh, yeah. I mean,
it's a given.
So far, I haven't had any complaints. I'm like, that show's great.
If you have Peacock, you can watch Pedro Pascal on NBC on the SNL.
I saw the Mario Kart.
The Mario Kart was great. There was some other one. Not everything was perfect, you know, because it's the new SNL. But there was a lot of good stuff. He did wonderful. He did really good. I really liked seeing him on there. There's even one sketch. I forget what they're doing. They're like in an Italian restaurant, and he's kind of giggling a lot, but they're all giggling a lot, which is always funny. Yeah. When they break character, like they're like, "Fuck, like we're laughing too much or whatever," because the absurdity of whatever it is, which is always great. So if you get a chance, check it out on Peacock. I think I said Peacock Plus earlier, which isn't a thing, but Peacock. Check it out on Peacock, the SNL episode. So, yeah. Anything else?
That's Harley Quinn. No, right. Just watch it. Like I said, it's fast. Watch it. It's easy.
Yes.
You'll like it.
Harley Quinn, HBO Max.
My wife,
in 20 minutes.
Not a comic book fan whatsoever. Enjoyed this show.
It's just fucking funny. It's funny adult humor, and if you like that, and you need a change.
She compared it to Robot Chicken, and many of you out there like it. She compared it to that. So.
Yeah, and if you just, again, like, you want some adult humor because you're tired of the same old PG-13 shit or PG shit, whatever you're watching, put it on at night, put it on in the bathroom when you're by yourself, whatever, and watch one episode, and you'll be laughing your ass off. You'll truly enjoy it, I think. So everything good to say about the Harley Quinn show. I got nothing else.
No, that's it.
Yep. All right, guys, something we like to say at the end of every show is that if there's something that you want to do, a hope, a dream that you wish to accomplish, go out and do it.
Harley did.
Today's the day. Seize the day. Harley when definitely
she wanted to
did.
Prove that she can be an A-lister without the Joker.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And prove her love for Poison Ivy. She absolutely did it. So seize the day, guys. Carpe diem. Go out and do it. And if there is something else we'd like to say at the end of the show, it is from the great Captain Steve Rogers at the end of, not the end, but kind of in the middle of Endgame. He reminds us, we got to do whatever it takes, guys. And so sometimes you've got to do whatever it takes, just like Harlz did. Harlz, Harlz and Ivy, or Harlz Ivy. That's what they're doing. Right. You got to do whatever it takes, guys.
And so she did. She wanted to give Ivy the best orgasm she ever had. She went out there and seized it.
Or what Bane did, in order that he could have a little bit more manhood.
Just make sure you read the directions before you apply shit.
Yeah. Like that. Well, like he said, he's a good size, but he's bigger his body, so it makes it look small. So.
What did he say? I think I heard him say it was Kawhi Leonard hands.
Yes,
on Andre the Giant's body.
Yeah. So hard at that. I wanted to talk to you. I'm glad you brought that up. I was like, fuck.
I was like, oh man.
If this is the last Kawhi reference I ever hear, I'm good with this. This is like it. You know, you're fucking great shit, guys.
Why is it burning?
That's my shit right there. Double A, you got the Bane voice now. Oh, I love man. It. All right, guys. I'm CM Chuck.
I'm Double A.
We're Just Another Friday Night. Sanitized Premiere Podcast with P Breaks. Check us out after this on Spotify. You can watch the video or you can listen to the audio. Anywhere else podcasts are available. You can watch us on YouTube. Please subscribe, hit the subscribe button, and you can also watch this video on Facebook Live while it's up. Go check it out. Make sure to like our reels and our YouTube shorts and our TikToks. All of everything just at the bottom of our names down there at JAFN Podcast. Help me get there. Don't worry. There we go. All of it at JAFN Podcast for Just Another Friday Night. Guys, good night. Have a happy Valentine's Day. Have a happy Super Bowl.
Yeah, have a happy Super Bowl.
We'll see you next week. Good night.